the White House, President Eisenhower signs the proclamation that makes Alaska's entry into the Union official, nearly 92 years after Lincoln's Secretary of State bought the territory from the Russian Tsar for $7 million.
The Alaska Wild Project podcast is brought to you by the following sponsors.
Barney's Sports Chalet, supplying hunters with the best hand-selected gear since 1963. The exclusive home of frontier gear built for the rugged Alaskan terrain. Your one-stop shop for all your outdoor needs. Visit Barney's today at 906 West Northern Lights.
Tailored Restoration 24-Hour Emergency Home Services, helping Alaskans restore their dreams since 1972. Services include fire, water, mold, post-emergency cleaning, repair, and remodeling. Give them a call in Anchorage, Eagle River, Matsu, or Fairbanks. Hit them up at tailoredrestorationalaska.com.
Total Truck and Alaska Overlander, Alaska's premier supplier for custom automotive accessories and overlanding products, providing all-inclusive rental vehicles and trailers custom outfitted to explore the Alaskan backcountry with a unique and convenient traveling experience.
TheTreehouseAK.com, located at 341 Boniface Parkway, Alaska's own and grown cannabis and CBD store. Ask the budtender what the strain of the day is to get your 10% off. The Treehouse, where the culture lives. AKO Farms, located in Sitka, Alaska, built from the ground up with concentrates as their single motivation, with exclusive products such as their sugar wax, full spectrum diamond sauce carts, and more. Ask your local budtender about AKO. Marijuana has intoxicating effects and may be habit forming and addictive. Marijuana impairs concentration, coordination, and judgment. Do not operate a vehicle or machinery under the influence. There are health risks associated with consumption of marijuana for the use of only by adults 21 and older. Keep out of the reach of children, and marijuana should not be used by women who are pregnant or breastfeeding.
The Bait Shack, located on Ship Creek upstream of the bridge. Can't miss the bright red shack. They are the go-to fishing gear rental and guide service on Ship Creek. Tight lines and fish on. Come hook into the action with them. Hit them up at thebaitshackak.com.
Snow Pro AK, your snow and ice management company specializing in business and residential properties. They know what it takes to keep your property presentable and safe. Give them a call for a free estimate at 280-7098 or visit lawnproak.com. Double Shovel Cider Company, located off of Arctic and 58th, handcrafted Alaskan-made colonial ciders. They also have a tap room downtown on the corner of 5th and E. Stop by today and taste an award-winning cider.
The Alaska Chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. BHA is the voice of our Alaskan public lands, waters, and wildlife. Their goal is to uphold our hunting and fishing legacy while keeping our public lands wild. Stand up today and join BHA at backcountryhunters.org.
Yeah.
Knock the noggin.
Brain's a little. Yeah. Oh, she's feeling it. You know, I've always like thought about that because I got to go with a buddy 2 years ago now that was, you know, he was going to take one with a bow. And it was, I mean, there's an unbelievable amount of strategy that was going to go into.
You brought his bow when we went, didn't we?
Yeah. No, I mean, Jake had his bow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, it's like if there's a chance. You know, whoever's up to shoot, even if it's the other dude that's up to shoot, but then you can get on a ram that's bow range, like let the dude with the bow take it.
Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like, yeah. I don't care if you took one last year and you're like the dude that's been waiting in line for 3 years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a believer in the batting order.
Yeah.
On multi hunting. So mm-hmm. It's like you kill one this year, I'll kill one next year. We just make that focus that so that everybody gets their shot.
I think batting order makes sense sheep hunting. I don't know if it makes sense in other hunts, but it definitely
does. Well, we use it moose hunting, and it's been great.
Yeah.
It's been really great.
Yeah. Man. Which is unique to your area.
Yeah. It just seems like if you look over the course of like a 10-year span, like everybody's had opportunities.
Yeah. No, that's cool.
You know, even though there is a group of us, you know, like my cousin who's killed the most sheep out of our group, moose. But he's made it happen.
Yeah, he gets, you know, after
he went rogue and did his own thing and was like, rousted one up.
Are we calling it rogue?
I call it rogue.
He's against the empire of moose.
Yeah, just like, oh.
Yeah.
We didn't talk about him doing that today.
Well, I also agree, like, if everyone's asleep and you're up, You're not going to be like, oh, you're not going to wake this guy up. Like, hey, it's your turn, buddy. I got one over here.
Yeah. Exceptions to the rule of the batting order. Yeah. All right. Exactly. Yeah. The dude doesn't want to come down and eat breakfast and nap for the day.
Yeah.
He's going to stay up there all day. You kill that damn thing.
Yeah, yep, for sure.
It's you, dog.
Yeah.
I'll be like, oh, there's a 56-incher. Wish Dan was up here.
Yeah,
get there him. Goes your moose.
Yep. I saw it.
I got a picture of it. I was looking at your Hoyt sitting there on the fucking stand. Where were you at?
That's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, the batting order.
Do you ever do the batting order, Daniel?
We did the batting order on all our sheep hunts.
Yeah.
Which makes sense.
Yeah.
Because you're always together.
Three of us got one, too, man.
But, of course, if you split up.
Yeah.
Which I don't think we really did.
Just once when we brought an extra guy, so we had four.
And we split it two different. Oh, yeah, we split two. Then it's whatever.
Yeah, when we would sheep hunt, my dad and I would do the batting order, but we wouldn't do the batting order with the rest of the group. So we would split up from them.
Oh, well, that makes sense. So. I mean, that was more or less... When you're like three guys, the batting order really comes into play when you go past two.
Yeah.
So you got main hunter or a guy... his partner, and then the third dude, it's kind of like, okay, batting order really. I feel like the same way when you're trolling for fish. You have four rods out. It's like, just pick a first guy to get the rod.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one. Because I thought we always did like, this is your rod, this is your rod, this is your rod, this is your rod.
One guy's like about to limit out. Like one guy's already got two, and then the other guy's got nothing, and it's like, okay, let the guy pick it up. Like that's kind of how I run it. You know?
Yeah, okay.
Trolling. Yeah, he's looking all long face and sad. You know, it's like all the kind of thing. You know,
That's how you learn, man.
I had the lucky rod today.
I mean, if I could see if a dude brought his custom, you know, trolling rod and setup, and like he spent $2,500 on this thing. He's like, this is my corner. You know, sticks it in the rod locker, and it's like, hey, man, everybody else has caught their six silvers, and you got nothing.
Yeah.
Like, if you want that, you sign up for it. That's what you came on the boat for, because that rod that you wanted to use. But as guiding, because I happened to do a month of silver guiding years ago, and I'm not going to say I'm a guide. I'm saying I was just a deckhand.
Yeah.
Fumbling and bumbling, super hungover every day. And everybody got fish when you just did a batting order.
Oh, yeah.
Turn for everybody. And I was like, oh, this works really well. And I thought about it for hunting. I'm like, oh, cool. Well, this is cool because, especially if you have a hunt where you have a multiple opportunity situation.
Yeah, yeah.
Sheep, I wouldn't say maybe is as opportunistic as a moose hunt, even though you get a lot of double taps with, you know, two
I rams think the together. Moose is like, who spots them, got them.
Yeah, no, that goes down a lot, the spot. But if you can get to them, like you guys are all starting in the same spot, Brandon. Where we're at, we're all at different spots. So it's like we kind of all have to close in together a lot of times. And
so that's happened in the past where a couple guys split off and went up over here, and then we've gotten moose over there. Uh-huh. And you know, this dude was on the knob and he was up to bat. Well, we had to make a decision with my other partner. I was like, well, I got a moose last year. I'm with you. You take this one.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Dan sits over here smoking cigarettes on the knob. He doesn't get a moose, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Eric does.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like, okay. But now Eric's out. Dan's batting order's still up.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? Yeah. So, yeah. No, totally. I mean, there's been occasions. It works, The last couple of years, though, we've gotten really lazy, and we just stopped moving and just went to the same.
Yeah. Well, it's working.
It's working.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Even though, man, it's hard not to want to, like.
Yeah.
In that case, batting order, for sure.
I think we deserve the ones that come into camp now, because I haven't had one come into camp in 20 years. So
yeah,
and we're ready for that one.
And when it does happen again, it'll be you'll taste it and savor it a lot longer.
I think we won't be ready anymore. I think it will kind of like someone will get up and be like, "Oh shit,
don't have their gun." He has dick in his hand. Oh yeah, rifle's over there, and he's over there. He's like, walks off.
Seven brow tines. Yeah, two sheets of plywood, man. That's the one.
There what else is batting order? Fresh pow? Or you just spread out?
That's a good one.
Yeah.
I wouldn't first dude down the thing.
It's usually whoever, like, somebody wants it and they're like, I'll film you. And then they just go, you know? That's usually what it is. Yeah. No friends on powder days, Daniel. Yeah, that's
kind of bad. Just batting order or batting order situation.
Yeah. I know I trolling for ramp. Kings.
Like the staging area, the boat ramp. like somebody pulls up and like I'm already there and they like run out and they do it really quick and then they zip in front of you and pull in and start backing. It's like I was about to go, dude.
Totally.
Like, yeah. Yeah. Staging area batting order is that should be a thing.
You know how that works though? Everybody needs to know what the fuck they're doing.
It's crazy, man. Like, right? Like you said, silver fishing. Mean, you know how it is. It was on the Kenai digit guide.
No. I was doing salt.
Oh, you're doing salt.
Yeah, okay. I was just ocean fishing.
Yeah. So I'm like early morning in the Kenai for silvers. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, 5:30, 6 a.m. No one can hardly see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Everybody's half-licked back and down. Yeah, it's screwy.
Let's just go. Ice fishing, batting order.
Yep.
If you're just got your tips going.
Really good one. Yeah, that's a good one for sure. You guess I got an ice house and four rods going or whatever.
Unless you're jigging, then of course you get one.
Okay, that's a good one too.
Yeah. Do you still stay in the batting order if you're jigging and the other ones aren't?
I don't think so. No. You got your rod in your hand.
You're not going to just set the hook and give it to the next guy.
Yeah.
Like I mean, I'm the one doing the work here. The exceptions to the rule, man. That's what I'm saying. Like in general. That's a good one. Like I'm trying to think of what else is a like a snow machine like thing. But that doesn't.
How about if you're working a trap line with a partner? You know, how would that go down? Who gets like the beaver? You know, the beaver pelt.
Oh,
and then you get to the next animal. It's a wolverine. You know, is it like I haven't had a wolverine in a while, or is it like you just got the beaver? So I get the wolverine.
If you're going with a partner, you're splitting it all anyway. Maybe you get it, then you got to do the work.
Yeah, but you know.
Or they're both work. So you went out that day. If you bring it back, I'll skin it. Like team it up. Because I'm sure they split the profits.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good one. I was thinking about like an upland bird hunting situation.
Oh, those are so fast, though.
Yeah.
It's kind of split second. Oh, no.
Well, my perspective on it would be like cruising down like a long trail. On a four-wheeler early in the morning.
Yeah.
Always the guy leading is going to be the guy that's going to see the grouse, spot the grouse, roust it up into a tree, have that first look at it. So what we've done in the past, because we've had some areas moose hunting too, or we've had some great pre-grouse hunting runs that you can do prior to going into camp. And it's like we would just do like a split, like psh, like you kill one, I kill one. You kill one, I kill one.
Yeah,
you know, and then you get lucky and you roust two, and you're like, okay, you go over him. I'm gonna go get this one, and then you know, and this is just 22 hunting. Yeah. This isn't.
That's when you have two.
Yeah, when you're working with a pointer, you definitely do use a batting order. And then, and then if you're spotting ptarmigan, we usually will kind of like walk in together, but someone's in a better position for the first shot, you know?
I've never upland bird hunted, like officially that way.
Oh, it's fun, man.
Cruising on a trail on a four wheeler is with a 22. Is that really upland bird hunting?
That's just stupid.
So you mostly like the downland?
Yeah, that's just stupid chickens.
Stupid chickens.
Yeah, but if you're upland, like you got a dog. I think if you have a dog, if you got a dog with, then you're legit.
Then it's like, okay,
we're doing this.
Or if you're poor college kids, you know, you're throwing like the dirt balls and the farm into the little rows and getting the pheasants to jump. But yeah,
I think that still qualifies.
Yeah, no, it does.
Man, winter's back.
Fuck.
I put the shovels away, cleaned the garage, put all the ice fishing stuff, brought out the spring stuff, started all that, and then
the shovels away.
Literally that night.
You're the one that cursed us. You put the shovels away, he's the one. You don't put the snow blower away, you just keep it all out.
That's right. You gas it up and get it ready, you know?
Yeah, so it's my fault.
That's a good attitude.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Daniel.
Yeah.
You're welcome. Put the ice fishing stuff away, but I put it in the front of the shed. Yeah. Like, not officially, like in the back corner.
Yes.
It's just like right. I can still grab it. Yeah. Like, hey.
Oh, you still want to go? Thing. Okay.
Yeah. I got you. It's a 2-minute walk back and forth. I'm good. Throw it in the truck.
But it makes it, you feel good just to, like, get it out of the garage.
Oh, well, I mean, yeah. I mean,
I got the big old sled with all the house and everything.
Well, I even called the Yamaha shop and was like, hey, man. I want to get my shit in and get service. He's like, perfect, and bring it in anytime. I'm like, oh my god, this is the window.
Oh, so your machine?
If you wait 2 weeks, he's gonna be like, yep. Can't touch for a month.
Yeah,
you know. So I like went out there, got it out there. Call me a week later. Dave out at Performance Yamaha, ready to go. I'm like, fuck yeah, Saturday. Grab the trailer, rip out there, blizzard.
Yeah.
Coming back. Mother.
Like, oh, that's really? Right.
You, yeah, that's right. Like, you came back, you're like, you're going today to get it?
Just put the shovels away.
Yeah. I come back and just grab the snowblower and clean the driveway before I park the trailer in the driveway.
Yeah.
Pissed. God damn. Well, because we're
what'd they do to it?
Just a routine repairs. Service. Okay. Yeah. I mean, oil change, front rear diffs, check the belt, you know, just. When you buy, it's kind of nice when you buy something brand new, they just take it back to the same dudes, and then they know the machine. And I mean, there's a lot to be said for that. Yeah. I mean, I know the guys like to do it themselves and keep track of their own shit, but
it's nice to be able to work on it.
It's $400. It is nice to know how to wrench on the machine.
Yeah,
it's so, also nice to just drop it off.
Yeah,
and pick it up and ride it and so, drop it off again. Yes.
Yeah.
That's kind of where I sign up.
I just don't want like the 20-mile in drop off, you know.
You know what I bring? Oh, yeah. For the, you know what I bring for not knowing how to work on it? A really good toe strap.
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
There you go.
It's like, hey, can you tow me out?
I actually want to get one of those. Shout out to the Total Truck. One of those like.
Oh, that like bungee.
Yeah, that's not really for towing big though, bubble, right? That's big what rope? Is that? That's for like punching you out of a hole.
Yeah, that's like for a yard out.
Yeah.
No.
And what is it?
It's like a what's a Bubba rope or something, and it's like a super thick.
Craig brought it to
me, but it has like party. A has like a lot of like stretch to it, so you're not gonna like snap anything. Yeah. It's just gonna let you like get it out.
Does that rock it back at you though if it comes off? Because you got all that stored energy.
It's not that. It's not a bungee cord.
No, I think they've designed it against that, Jack.
So stretch, it'll just Bubba rope stretch recovery. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, like it's a
it's better than using like the strap.
Yeah.
Like I've been using. Or the toe strap. Yeah. Yeah, those are nice.
Yeah. Anyway.
But it won't recoil or it does recoil?
It just meant so it's not gonna like rip off your freaking whatever.
It's kinda like the snow machine that hook.
Yeah, what is that called?
That toe hook for snow machines. It's like real short, but it expands, so it's like
yeah, it's got a name.
You pull, and it kind of loads up and helps pull the machine out.
Right.
You
know what I mean? Speaking on ropes, so it's not static, because I learned this. So I was like,
"Whoa, hold on!"
So as I was cleaning the garage, I'm looking at the raft that's rolled up. I was like, oh, "I need some new rope for this raft."
Yeah, yeah.
So I started like calling some people, and I was like, "What is the best rope like for this?" Because I've been buying the shitty cheap rope.
Yep.
Every year, every 2 years, the one that comes rolled up in the whatever.
Yeah.
And then last year, the rope broke, so I had to use one of my, like, throw bag ropes.
Oh, shit, yeah.
So in my mind, I was like, oh, I need one of these ropes. So I started talking to everyone, and they're like, oh, dude, what you want is a climbing rope. Like, those are the best ropes. Yeah. And I was like, oh, okay. I was like, good idea. So then I went to look for climbing ropes. I went to REI. I went to Hardy Marmot.
Yeah.
And I was like, these are fucking expensive.
Yep.
And then I was like, what is the difference in all these? And I just started like learning. I was like, oh, they're static. There's this. There's the float. There's the this. I was like, oh, I didn't learn. I didn't know any about this. So I started asking. I was like, what kind of rope do I want? And then I was like, well, I'm not going to spend
$300
on a fucking rope.
Yeah.
I was like, I'll just go buy the cheap one for another 6 years.
Yep.
So then I'm telling like the teacher at work, and she's like a climber, and she's like, oh, yeah, you can get online. And people are like, sell.
Oh,
like their used rope, which would rope. Still be good for you because you're not using it to like
climb,
you know. I was like, oh, that's a good idea. And then for some reason, I just popped up on Facebook. It read my mind. And there's this dude that was selling the exact rope I wanted, the color I wanted for $100, like double what I wanted.
Yeah.
So I was like, hit him up. I was like, yo, I'm coming. I want it. And he had just lowered the price. I was like, perfect. Sweet. So it was $100 for like a 50 meters, so it was like more than I needed.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, well, I could use the other stuff.
We got the bubble rope in action.
Here. Was it a static rope?
It was
a
static rope.
Yep.
So I go out there and I go to Eagle River to meet the guy and get the rope, and it's beautiful. And he's wearing an Alaska Wild Project shirt.
Hell yeah.
He's like, what? Because he had the hat on. He's like, oh my God, this is for you guys. And I was like, oh, cool, right on. So shout out to that guy with the static rope that came through. Oh, look how thick that is.
Oh, yeah.
I got a delay. Oh, that's for the truck. Delay there. Here we go.
Okay, so the Bubba rope.
Oh, yeah, there it goes.
You got that Got that.
So it just doesn't let it like the full initial yank.
Yeah. Yep.
And you can just get going.
Yeah.
Well, it allows the momentum to tug on it. Yeah. To get a good tug on it.
Yeah. And the puller can still have some momentum with that too.
Yeah, I'm going to buy one of those.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's cool.
That is pretty badass. Anyway, I want to share that with you guys. That's a good one for the rig. I think those those tracks.
Argos? I don't
know what they are. No,
the mud flap things.
I mean, they're downstairs at Total Truck right now.
They're tracks that you put on.
Yeah, if you like get mats. Stuck and you're in mud and you can stick them in there so you get traction.
Like okay. Mat tracks or whatever they are.
Something tracks they're called.
Yeah, okay.
I should mat know.
Tracks.
I'm having a brain fart on them. Craig, forgive me. Learn me up on this shit.
He gave a pair away.
He had a recovery kit at the meat party. We had a bubble rope, 20-inch rigid light bar, the bubble rope.
And the tracks.
I want to see some flares or something else, too.
Who took that one?
I know who it is.
And it kind of got pieced apart. It was one package.
Oh, it was? Okay.
Not the light bar, but the recovery kit and the light bar were kind of supposed to be one package. I'm going to do a lot better with the giveaways next year and have that structured way, way, way better for the meat party. I found an area of improvement that was like a number one priority, and it was that for next year.
Perfect.
So not to rabbit hole into that.
Just call Ira. He can set you up with some, models to take care of it for you.
That's what we do. We just pass it off to Ira and his models.
Doctor models.
Just come doctor models. Rolling deep with just...
Not only are there models, they're doctors.
Yeah. They were even like torching smart models. For them.
Watch out, boys.
She's like, love you, Ira.
Can I buy a hat? I'm just like...
You don't want one for free?
I mean, I'll just give you one.
We just need a be like Ira
hat. Can you check my pulse?
Ira's over here with his torch and shit, just burning meat.
That's funny. The boys went out and slayed the Kenai. I was supposed to go, but I had to work. Unfortunately, work got in the way.
Slayed the Kenai? What happened?
The trout. Tyler and them went out there. They said they caught like 40 something in one day.
Oh, nice.
I guess it
was just section popping. Did they go to?
I think they hit the middle.
Okay.
It's still iced over out there, but have you been going?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Matt was looking at you like,
he's like, why are you telling people about the Kenai?
No, keep it. No.
Don't go. It's still winter.
Yeah. It's all iced over. No, you can't fish it. You can't fish it.
It snowed and it actually went back.
But if you do fish it, you need one of these rods.
Yep.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
Welcome to Alaska Wild Project, episode 112. Today we have Matt Crowe from Alaska Rod Co. Ooh, that rhymes.
Hey, there you go.
Nice. Welcome.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Yeah.
Beautiful stuff you got there.
Thanks, man. Yeah, it's an addiction. So, you know, whenever you can blend, like we were talking before, addiction with your work, it just kind of gets crazy, man.
Magical.
It's magical.
I kind of want to start on the end of the experience. Yep. I need a new salmon recipe.
Okay.
You got one you can share?
The full circle?
The full start right at the end, and then we're going to go back to the beginning.
So for me, I'm not a big like fillet of salmon guy.
Okay.
And so I'm a big like canned salmon.
Ooh, right?
So like salmon dip, but I get the canned salmon, I'll make salmon patties, I'll make salmon dip, or just made like a salmon Alfredo. You take the canned salmon, put in like a Alfredo thing, you know.
Okay.
So that's more my speed, you know. My wife cooks the slab of salmon, you know.
These are smoked. This is also smoked salmon.
No, it's just canned.
Just
canned. You put it in a canner, you're like the pressure canner.
Yeah, cook it.
Do that. Pressure, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that's more my speed.
What's your salmon dip?
Salmon dip. So it has like green onions in it, some mayonnaise, some relish, and then celery.
Like a salmon salad.
Yeah, like salmon salad, salad sandwiches.
Love it.
Pretty simple, though.
Really simple. But my favorite was the ranch wheat thins you can make with. But then wheat thins just discontinued.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, so I'm hoarding boxes in my kitchen. Oh. I went out and bought them all, so I'm like, I'm hoarding ranch wheat thins now. It's awesome. The best to eat with them, yeah.
Do you ever take that salmon salad and throw it on some bread or like a pita, and then you broil it with some cheese on top and paprika?
Ooh, that's fancy.
Yeah, salmon.
Sounded like a lot. Have you ever done
it's
this?
A salmon melt.
When you lost me a broil. I'm like, boy, I'm like, wow, that's a lot of work.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I have been like kind of like the grilled cheese kind of thing. Like, put it, spread it out, and put some cheese on it, and then like kind of like grill it up. But
have you done any air frying
with
the salmon? I keep telling Lexi to try it because like it keeps popping up on my Instagram. Like, try this, and it's like, put the mustard on there and air fry, boom, boom, boom. And I keep telling her. And
I haven't done fillets. I've done like the, but I love the salmon melt. So you know, the salmon salad on like bread or pita, and I have done that in the air fryer, but not like a fillet.
Yeah,
sounds dope.
Like cook the actual slab in there.
Not the whole slab, but yeah, like you probably do half of it.
Like steaks?
Yeah, and the way they did it, like they just put like some mustard on there and a little spray and just, it was like, look golden and just beautiful. Put it on some
local green salad.
Oh, it looks so good.
Do you guys use your air fryer much?
We do.
I do.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
Every once in a while.
I mean,
we go through a lot of dino nuggets.
Oh, yeah. Dude. It's a dino cooking machine, dude.
I mean, I've been kind of like cooking stuff in there that's kind of questionable.
Have you done a steak yet?
No, I will not do a steak.
Dude.
But really? What I have been doing, though?
The steak. You know who told me? Big Kyle.
Oh,
you
really?
Know Big Kyle knows some food.
Oh, I can only imagine. It's probably just perfect.
Damn. Yeah. Oh, it was. He's like, this is what you do. You spray it. You season it exactly like this. Turn it over. Boom. Best steak you ever had. It was awesome.
What I've been doing.
I'm going to have to do it.
And it's quick. And you don't have to like stink up the whole house.
No, I mean, that's the thing. It's quick and clean.
Yeah.
You're not cooking something on the stove.
Yeah.
Yep.
I will. I have this fresh... load of jalapeno cheese Polish that I got from Wags.
Oh, yeah.
Moose. Some good moose. Jalapeno cheese dogs. I didn't even package them. I just put them in a trash bag, and I just been crushing them.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm not even going to save these for summer. I'm just going to eat these things through for, like, lunches and stuff through the week, right? Boil them for 5 minutes. Throw them in that air fryer for 5 minutes.
Okay.
Mm. Cheese is popping, cracking. It's like you throw it on the cast iron after you boil.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it's in the air fryer.
Oh yeah,
I just do straight frozen right into the air fryer for the jalapeno cheddars. Yep, and then when I cook the moose dogs for kids' lunch, same thing, just straight in.
Shit.
Yep,
I'm doing too much work.
Yep,
I could just go one step.
Yep, or I'm just lazy, but it works and they're bomb.
And you wouldn't know the difference, huh?
I don't think so. I'm like, when I eat it, I'm like, damn, how this cooks it better than I can cook it any other way.
I do the wings in there too now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I do that too.
Yeah, wings are good.
It takes a little longer, but you know what doesn't work?
Empanadas.
Does not work.
No.
Which is weird.
Dude, it is not good.
It's terrible. So we went, my uncle in Soldatna's trying to like start an empanada thing. So we.
Like a hot dog stand, but empanadas?
Yeah, he's doing it at his hot dog place. And actually, over where you're at.
Yeah.
And so we went and picked up a bunch to cook because I was trying to support his, and all the hockey boys were like, oh, I'll take 50, I'll take 50, 50, 50. So we ended up getting like a freezer full.
Oh, yeah, I was pumped.
And I was pumped too until I put them in the air fryer, and they were so whack. I went immediately downstairs and grabbed the fryer, the deep fryer. I was like, I know what to do here.
Dude. My kids will never eat empanadas again.
You got to do it again in the deep fryer.
What are they like mushed out or what are they just?
It just didn't get crispy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just didn't get crispy. Kind of just got like kind of toasted.
Was it corn? What's the breading made out of?
Like eating a whack ass Hot Pocket?
Yeah, that's what it ended up being like. Which actually, the Hot Pocket in the air fryer probably.
It'd be like a weak ass Hot Pocket wrapped with like corn dog corn outside. You know, because that you didn't fry. Masa,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah, because the inside's cooked and then the outside needs to be fried.
Right.
But also the key on that is just straight frozen. Like, don't let them defrost. Just go frozen right into the deep fryer or oil in the pot.
Right, that's what you got.
Okay.
Right.
Oh, man, another funny thing. So I went to pick up the freezer at Joe's because Joe let us take it over there. He drove, so we left the freezer there, and so I go over there to distribute all the empanadas, and then I was like, all right, well, I'll take the freezer to my house.
He just gave you a whole freezer?
Yeah.
Not a cooler?
No. That's what I told him. I said, can you get in a cooler? He's like, oh, well. He just gave me the freezer. I think in his mind he's like, well, I'll give him the freezer, and then when I go down to Costco to get more shit, I'll have the freezer there because he connected to his truck
or his
trailers. Yeah, and so he'll just have everything frozen directly from Costco or wherever he's getting the stuff right into the freezer.
Sense. Yeah.
Which is smart. So in his mind, he's like, I know what I'm going to do. But what he doesn't know is that I fucked up his freezer. I put it in, and I put it in the wrong way when I strapped it in the trunk. I didn't put it backwards. So I'm driving down Minnesota with the empanadas, my empanadas, and a couple other people, and the door just flies open, dude. I'm like, oh shit. I like pull over right on the side of Minnesota, dude, and I had to like move the cooler and restrap, and people were just driving by, dude. Empanadas everywhere.
Road spray.
Windshields.
So it just like ripped like that back panel and disconnected from the foam, and I've been at home trying to like fix it. It's almost fixed. We'll see. He doesn't listen, so he's not gonna know, but it's almost
might not be a maximum seal.
It's definitely not a max, it's not sealed at all, but I'm like, if you put a hinge on this.
Yeah, put a cinder block on top.
Yeah, that's all you need.
Just smash it.
And that's like, it's an old freezer. So I'm like, this guy's like gonna get a new one out of me. I was like, nah. No.
I mean, he gave it to you, so that's kind of, you know, he's kind of asking for it.
Like you could have gave me all that in a cooler.
Yeah, you don't just give freezers away. I feel like you just kind of,
especially not old ones.
Especially because I know what he was doing. He's like, I know, I'll go down there. There'll already be a freezer there.
Old freezers are the best ones.
Oh, they last forever. The new ones, they only last a couple years. And I mean,
they thaw and they fucking freezer burn your shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's a speed limit on those.
I think you just got to use what do you call that, Jack? Get all technical with the wind and the like, aerodynamics. Like you need to get the fucking.
No, I was just being stupid. I just put it in the back, like right by the tailgate.
Well, you're probably already
the wrong way, so then it just like flops.
Well, you're probably already frustrated and wondering why would anybody give me a freezer?
I know,
anything?
Dude. Yeah.
As you're just wrestling it and trying to shift it. Fucking freezer! Why would you?
Yeah. So anyway. I was spending some time trying to fix that thing and put some screws in there. Maybe you won't notice.
There you go.
We'll see.
So did you guys talk about your Homer trip on the last pod?
I think we did.
I wasn't here.
Yeah. We have a belt.
So can I get a quick, like.
Yep. You go to episode 110 and, or 111.
111.
Yeah.
It's there. Mm. No, we won the belt. We are the champions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We are the best hockey players that went to Homer in the intermediate division.
Yeah. Last weekend. Or 2 weeks only. Ago.
Is that the highlight of one's hockey career?
Oh, ours.
Yeah.
For this year, for sure.
Okay.
Well, it is cool because now the belt has three names on it, because previously they didn't have a belt. So now this is the third win on the belt. And either Daniel and I have been on the belt winning team every time now. Yep. So that's cool because we won the first time. Then Daniel stole it back from us. And then Daniel joined us, and now we
joined forces. Now you guys win the belt every
now
year.
We're just going to win it every year. Yeah. Well, the team we played was really good, though. It went to OT. And,
really?
Yeah, and it was our old goalie that we were playing. So we really wanted to shoot him up, but he played a hell of a game and kept it tight. Was it 4-3 we won?
3-2. I think it was 2-2 at the end of the game.
It was 4-3. Yeah, it was 4-3. We were up 3-2, and then they scored with
wasn't
like,
there.
Yeah. Anyway.
I feel like I should have been a groupie there, though.
Yeah. It was a long weekend.
Yeah.
There's a lot of groupies out there.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
the beer is flowing.
Oh, I bet.
Insider. Oh, hockey games? Oh, yeah. Are you guys playing hockey, or are you like
coaching? No, we're playing. Oh, we're playing. Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is beer league old man shit.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you guys do the no checking thing?
We had 24 minutes of penalties in one game.
And so. The game's 40 minutes.
Yeah. We were not at full strength very often.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah. No, it sounds like it's a fundraiser for the rink out there. There's a kind of a storied kind of pass to the rink, but basically they need to raise money to keep the rink alive and be able to pay rent for the building.
Okay.
And so they do this tournament in the spring, and then they do one in the fall that's really cool. It's like a mashup tournament where you just sign up and write your skill level down, and then they just kind of throw sticks in the middle, and you end up on a team with some people you might know, some you don't. And
that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Are you talking the rink that's like on Spit?
It's on the Spit.
I've always wanted to go in there. Yeah. I always drive it, and every time I'm on the Spit, I'm technically nice not really going there for like a hockey rink.
Yeah.
Kevin Bell Arena.
Yeah, Kevin Bell Arena.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to stop in there.
Yeah, but it's a great time. The people at Homer are amazing. The hospitality is great, and it's a fun time.
Well, I was just seeing all the photos. I was like, man, these are all dudes I love to spend time with and hang out, and yours are all in one space.
Yeah.
One time. I'm like, yeah. Man, like,
put on some skates and learn how to play. Come on out.
I could just put on skates and gear and never get on the ice and just sit on the bench and hang out.
You got this, boys.
I could get dressed and just hang out on the bench. I could be like the backup goalie that never gets playing time. You know?
That would be funny.
Yeah.
You could get Don Cherry suits and come be the coach.
Oh, that's what I need to
do. There you go.
I definitely need to do that.
Get Swarney as your assistant coach. You guys have fun.
Just pace back and forth, my hands in my pockets.
Yep.
Bark a few calls like I know what I'm talking about.
Swear loud.
You can yell at the refs so we don't get penalties for it.
There we go.
Yeah. Just
put me in the box.
You skate, Matt?
No. Well, I try, you know, and it's a sin because I grew up in Minnesota.
Oh,
so, you know, it's crazy hockey state.
I can hear it in your voice.
Oh, Minnesota.
The tireder, the more tired I get, the more my accent comes out. But I grew up in Minnesota, but I was never into hockey. I can't throw football. I can't, you know, I'm not really athletic. But so growing up, it was more power sports. It was dirt bikes, snow machines, all that kind of stuff. Hunting, fishing, you know, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I don't have an athletic bone in my body.
Okay. Minnesota just lost. Championship.
Yeah.
Who's the champs?
The Gulf or
Quinnipiac.
Yep.
Where are they? Their boys out of
Connecticut.
Yeah.
Sweet.
They never won it. Kind of small school.
Yeah. I mean, up against they're in the mix all the time, though.
Yeah. Within the last 10, like 5 years.
Yeah. As far as the Frozen. Yep.
The coach had been there like 19 years and took them. Was it 19 or 29? It might have been 29. He'd been there a long time. He took them like before they were even D1.
And got him a chip this year.
And then this was his third try at the championship game. So he nailed it.
Damn, yeah. He's running a good program.
Those boys came back too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was
good. That was tough. Yeah, good. They had a good run. That was good. Good for them.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah.
You see UAA up there. Go Seawolves.
The people here, because I don't really, I go to a couple hockey games like the Brown Bears, something like that. But I went the other day and I missed the people throw fish for the first goal here. Like in Minnesota, we always threw like a pike or a walleye on the ice.
Yeah.
The people here, throw one. I was waiting for the fish. Where's the salmon?
Like, oh, only on like the major. They used to do it at the Aces.
It was a pretty big game. It was Brown Bears versus Fairbanks, I think.
Yeah. Maybe they don't do it for the juniors.
Maybe I missed it, but that was like my thing. I went there. I'm like, all right, where's the fish?
Yeah.
Do the Wolverines do something?
I don't know. I've never been to a Wolverines game.
Wolverines just beat the Brown Bears.
They just won. No, they just won the whatever cup.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Yeah. Nice. Against the Brown Bears.
They're out of the playoffs, but they won the season.
Alaska, whatever.
Yeah, the last cup between the
regional.
Yeah.
They should throw something.
Yeah.
What?
Empanadas.
No, it's going to be Alaska. Like a
salmon melts.
Well, salmon's obvious.
They should throw a pink.
Yeah,
a pink salmon. Yeah, I feel like that's a good one, you know, and use it for dog food after that or something.
Well, then the dogs have to run out and grab them off the ice.
There you go. You know? Yeah, send old Roy out there and grab the pink something. Yeah.
Perfect.
I kind of like it.
Yeah, old Roy.
We'll call the Wolverines and let them know what's next.
Yeah.
They just have the team dogs just ready for that fish to hit the ice.
Or just like one shrimp.
What did he throw on there? I can't see. What is that thing? The biggest prawn you can possibly catch.
They should have like a traditional thing? Like a Wolverine, like a real one.
Oh, yeah.
A
real
Wolverine. Yeah. Walk it out. A live one.
Or maybe that's what you do. You throw a ptarmigan on, and then everyone's looking around. Where's the Wolverine? And then it just jumps on the ice and goes, gets it.
But that might be more entertaining than the hockey.
Yeah, they're going to have to move to a bigger arena.
Then they need to score more goals.
The Wolverines just in the cage in the bench, just waiting. Right by the penalty box for the other team.
Like Helga for the Georgia Bulldogs, just over there.
Well, that's what I'm saying. All the big schools have, like, their actual mascot.
Yeah.
You know?
Michigan Wolverines don't have a Wolverine in a cage, I can tell you that.
Yeah.
You think you raise one up from a pup?
Are they pups?
I don't know. What is a Wolverine baby?
It seems like it'd be a pup.
Look it up real quick.
So. I feel like that would be a really good
trivia.
Trivia.
Yeah.
Pup. I'm saying pup. What do you think?
I think it's pup.
Pup. Wolverine pup.
Yeah.
But what is Wolverine? It's more like a.
It's
closely related to the rats.
Yeah.
It's not like
it's like a. It's an rodent.
Is it a rodent?
What is a badger? Like a
badger? Yeah. Yeah. Badger.
The weasel. Like, it's like in the weasel family. Yeah. Yeah.
Like a fisher or a marten.
Like yeah.
Isn't that like yeah. rodent territory?
Yeah, long rats.
Is it rodent?
I don't no, know. It's
when
not
I see a badger,
rodent.
I don't think rodent.
It's not rodent, no.
All right, look at us. We got
I feel like if you
looked hands.
At a wolverine, like you rodent, yeah, you're feeling pretty fucking offended and bite your throat out.
Yeah.
So not happening.
Yeah, so put in there wolverine.
Man, I think it's a pup too.
Wolverine. Young?
Young? Wolverine.
Baby, just put baby name or baby
name. There you go.
Baby name.
Oh, baby Wolverine clothes. Baby clothes. All
right. No, no, sorry guys. Wolverine.
I really want you to put clothes, bud.
What is the one? It's Wolverine. What is it?
It eats Arctic fox. I didn't know that. I didn't know he eats fox.
Okay, I got pup.
It's called a kit.
A kit?
Yeah. How many pups do wolverines have?
Don't they call... No, it's not otters. They don't call otters kits, right?
Go down a little bit. No, just go down real quick. Go to that. Are wolverines a type of bear? Click on that. I want to. I know it's not, but what's it going to say? Was actually the largest member of the weasel family.
Yeah.
Okay. It's a weasel.
Right. Yeah, you're right.
Also called mustelids.
Hmm.
Well, those says pup. Go back down.
I mean, just the images do, yeah.
No, go down, it said.
It's officially a kit.
Down a little bit more. Right there. Animals of the world, wolverine pup.
Hmm.
But kit, I've heard that too before.
Kit? Like KIT?
Yeah.
Why don't you just put, what is a wolverine baby called?
That's what I typed.
Yeah.
A kit or a whelp?
Whelp?
Yeah.
A whelp?
Yeah. It's like help with a W in front of it.
I feel like the pup is probably just the more like understandable phrase.
Yeah.
If you were like, it's a kit or something, you'd
or
be like,
whelp.
You'd be
yeah,
like, whelp. What is that?
Whelp, I'm like,
Yeah. Oh,
it is
on the so baby weasel is like a, not a pup. I mean, that makes sense.
That's a whelp.
The WolverineFoundation.org says it's kits or cubs.
Cubs?
Cubs.
Mm-hmm. Cubs. Okay.
Cubs is
I can
real.
See cubs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wolverines are more, you know.
I mean, we're just looking at images there. They look like baby bears.
Yeah.
They kind of do.
That. Yeah.
Have you seen that wolverine? How many have you seen, in the wild?
You know, I've seen one, and I'm pretty sure it was wolverine, not confirmed, on our sheep hunt, running off with toilet paper.
Oh, ours. Oh, yeah.
I know
that
sounds weird, but I woke up, and I went a distance to use the restroom area, and was coming back, and I saw something scurrying over a small rise, and we were down at the bottom of a creek bed, and I saw something's butt wiggling, shimmying up over the hump for a second and a half. Just a second. And I'm like, what the hell could it have been? And it was what I imagined a wolverine's ass.
Well, you thought it was a caribou at first.
No, that was a different time.
Okay.
Yeah.
I saw a caribou run
down
that hill.
Yeah, he did, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I've only seen two.
Not like in the wild like that, no.
Yeah, just two.
I've only seen two.
I don't think I've seen one. I don't know. I've seen like badgers and stuff. A wolverine? I don't know.
Yeah. Can't see. You got to do the call.
The wolverine call?
Yeah.
You don't just see them. It's not just a critter that you...
Well, unless you put toilet paper out.
I mean... I saw something run over a rise with toilet paper. I mean, with a strip of toilet paper. I was like... Here.
Incredibly fast.
Yeah. I mean, it was just a boom, and it was gone. But I know I saw it. I mean, I was just walking back to the tent at 6 a.m. in the morning. It was freezing fucking cold coming out of our sheep hunt, and... I'm just kind of like, all I want to do is get back in my bag. You know, I'm coming back to the teepee and I just doing this thing. And I'm like, what could that have been that's that big? Mm-hmm. I mean, it had to be a wolverine.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people see him up in the Brooks Range sheep hunting.
Yeah.
Was it in the Brooks?
It was in the Brooks. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's
I seen it in Eureka.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Not everyone was shooting at it.
No, the guy that I was at tried to get after it, but he couldn't get to it. It was my neighbor and his like friend in the military. And that thing took off.
Yeah.
It was gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I saw one on the Deshka once on the beach playing.
Oh, man, what a cool spot to see one.
Yeah, it was, I don't know how many miles up. I was up a ways and I was fishing on one side and just around the bend, like kind of like summer solstice type time, real late at night. And it was just playing on the beach. I don't know if it was trying to fish or whatnot, but it was running up and down the bank and obviously a wolverine. It was cool.
Oh, yeah, you'd know. I mean, I've seen coyotes on the river.
Yeah, I've seen coyotes.
Yeah.
Wolves. So, yeah.
Yeah, not a wolverine. I mean, I just don't think there's a lot of them.
No.
So there's not just a population where.
Yeah. Are they like cagey too in the daytime? Are they more like a.
They're more like an evening nocturnal
type thing? Yeah.
Totally.
I'd have to believe that.
Yeah.
I mean, I think most folks are successful in seeing them or getting them in the wintertime.
Okay.
Yeah. Or they're trapping.
Or trapping.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they're even kind of hard to trap. I mean, they're pretty smart. And, yeah. I just think it's one of those things. It's like, I'm going to say it's like great white buffalo, but I'm a lifelong Alaskan and I haven't seen a wolverine. You guys said you've seen one twice.
Yeah.
You probably just saw a moose walking down your.
And how many? In your house hundreds and hundreds of. Days in the out.
Oh,
in the
yeah.
Oh, right.
So look many. At that. Yeah.
Or even flying small aircraft in tight spaces looking down on open area.
Mm-hmm.
You'd see one scurrying. I mean, if you were
in the right spot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just not something you see.
Yeah.
We were talking about that at the Barrett Entry event out at Palmer House last Friday. We had the biologist, Chris was his name? And a guide that was out there and you know, one of the hardest things to count are critters like that, you know, bears, wolverines, you know, they're hiding in the woods, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're there, but you just don't see them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, they're low profile, low thick brush.
Mm-hmm.
They could be there and you flying over, you don't see them.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, maybe there are more than what we think, but.
Yeah. Maybe they're sneaky too. Like whenever you're bear hunting, like Minnesota, we'd be bear hunting, and it's like you always hear like stuff like deer or like a moose. Oh, they always come crashing through the woods.
But yeah.
Most of the time, I would just be sitting there, kind of waiting, and boom.
Yeah.
They're just right in front of you. They're
quiet.
Those big pads. Like they're so quiet. It's crazy.
They are.
Like slither.
Yeah.
In the woods.
Yeah.
Can you give us your best wolverine call?
Oh shit.
What do those things even sound like? That I just imagine they sound god awful.
Yeah, well, if they're in the weasel family, maybe they're like screaming or screaming and stuff like that. Because I know weasels, they scream like crazy,
right?
Like, and weasels have like that musk, almost like a skunk. Like when I was a kid, a weasel
like a castor somehow, kind of smell.
Yeah, we had a 2-level house, and somehow a weasel got in downstairs, ran 2 flights of stairs up into my room underneath my bed, and then must everywhere.
Oh, no.
What an asshole.
I know, but yeah, it was crazy. He wouldn't come out underneath the bed.
Yeah.
And we didn't want to like shoot him under the bed like some redneck shit. And so we just had a big rat trap, and we put some chicken on it, and then we shut the door, waited 15 minutes, and snap.
Is that quick?
Yeah, and went back in there, and there he was, a little white one. Got him out there.
You know what you do next time?
Huh?
You just get some toilet paper and just roll it on out.
There you go. Yeah. A little piece of toilet paper at the door. Yeah.
You might, have to, you might have to wipe and leave it in there. I think there's a little something to that toilet paper. That
flavor it up.
So it went in there and like sprayed under your bed?
It was like a musk.
Like it's a little gland in its ass sprayed out. I guess
he ran under there and we had a big, we had a duck dog, big, like almost 90-pound lab, just big bruiser, and so he was chasing this thing, and he ran underneath my bed, and this big lab's about lifting the bed up, and he's like just crawling and stuff, and then obviously the weasel's like in distress and he's gonna die, so then he just voided his bowels or something, but dude, it was so bad.
In your bedroom?
Yeah, in my bedroom too. I don't even think we I was younger. I don't even remember like pulling the bed out, really. Just kind of like squirted some like cleaner under there, and then like open the window and just let air out. Right. So I just remember laying there thinking like, man, this stinks.
Yeah. Yeah, your dad's like, I had 2 weasels under my bed. And like, you got this.
It's all week number 4. You're like.
Yeah, like it's still here.
Still kind of smell it.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you're just getting used to it. Your buddy comes over and he's like, God damn, bro.
What you been doing in here?
Some socks under your bed?
Let's come right back. I got to pee now.
Okay.
Barney Sports Chalet, supplying hunters with the best hand-selected gear since 1963. Barney specializes in supplying hunters with the absolute best Alaskan proven gear on the market for some of nature's most rugged and demanding terrain. Whether you're headed to the remote volcanic islands of the Alaska Peninsula in search of a brown bear, or the shale-infested glacial valleys of the Brooks Range for dull sheep, it is critical you choose the right gear for your dream hunt. Don't miss Barney's exclusive brand, Frontier Gear of Alaska, tested from the high mountains of Tajikistan to the extreme conditions of Alaska. These products were designed for high performance and durability. Frontier Gear was derived from decades of experience hunting big game in Alaska. Paired with other top brands, it provides you the absolute best gear selection anywhere in the world. Stop in at Barney Sports Chalet in Anchorage on Northern Lights or check out their custom website and reference tool at barneysports.com.
The Alaska chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. BHA is the voice of our Alaska public lands, waters, and wildlife. From national level policy work to engagement with boots on the ground projects from Kotzebue to Ketchikan, BHA performs public land cleanups, hunting and fishing clinics, and community education to help take your game to the next level. BHA's community-minded goal is to uphold our hunting and fishing legacy while keeping wild lands wild and fostering the next generation of sportsmen and women for years to come. Make sure to follow BHA Alaska for upcoming events, local brewery pint nights, and more. Stand up for Alaska public lands and waters by supporting the Alaska chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. Join us today at backcountryhunters.org.
The Treehouse AK, your one-stop dispensary located at 341 Boniface Parkway. Be sure to ask the bud tender about their deal of the day, because honestly, there's always something good on deck. And guys, listen, this is where the culture lives. At the Treehouse, their dedication to servicing consumers has been developed through a lifetime of involvement in the cannabis culture. They're committed to providing the highest quality products at whatever value your budget affords, while always maintaining the deep-rooted principles that have carried them this far. Their focus is on relationships over transactions, and you can always depend on them to treat you with the respect you deserve. Hit them up at thetreehouseak.com, and remember, you must be 21 years of age to enter their store.
Real quick, before we get back to the show, I want to give a quick shout out to our sponsors. Sponsors make this whole thing happen. Just talking about earlier, we need to get our Patreon up. Patreon members, new and old, we are going to raffle off a giveaway. We've got a few things here at the studio that are ready for a new home. So new Patreon members, sign up and hit us up, and we'll send you something cool. I'm not going to tell you what it is, but
yeah, we have a bunch of cool stuff to give away to some Patreon members. Patreon.com/Alaska Wild Project. Or you can just go to our website, and then there's a link if you scroll down there to get that. And then we also have a Heather's Choice promo code. If you go to hers, it's Alaska Wild. If you forget it, it's also on our website and on our Instagram. And you get, I believe, 10 or 15% off your entire order.
What's that new Packaroon that she just came out with, the pumpkin?
She has a bunch. Actually, that's part of...
That new new?
Yeah, that new new.
Just giving a teaser, bro.
I think that's part of what we're giving away.
Is it?
We have some of those.
Maybe, maybe not.
Guess depends.
A new Patreon member, we'll have to find out.
Yeah. Yeah. And actually, there's some Patreons on there. If you haven't been on there, there's like 3 or 4 podcasts that we never put out that are just like crazy stories that we put out, and we plan on maybe doing some more on there. Stuff that maybe shouldn't go out to the general public. So if you really want to get down and dirty, yeah, those hit the ones, Patreon.
We going Shitka, or what's going on there?
Yeah, we actually probably need to put out that Shitka, but I feel like we need to have Sydney up here.
Yeah.
We need to have him up here, and we'll do this. Fun. And we'll do the...
I kind of want to hear it, too, before it goes.
That was like OG time.
We need to have him on there, and we'll do the Shitka story. Yeah. Or dump truck. we have him and dump truck, and me and you. We're gonna have a hell of a.
I'm gonna have a metal detector downstairs.
Did any names other than yours really get thrown out there?
No, I don't think so. Yeah. You know who'd be really fun to have on is the Rappin' Cabin Captain.
The Rappin' Captain. The Rappin' Cabin.
Yeah, man, Courtney would be awesome to have on.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Google or YouTube. Go to YouTube. Go to actually go to YouTube.
The only YouTube name that got thrown out of the whole
thing. Actually, go to YouTube right now, real quick, and go Rappin' Cappin'.
He was good to us, man.
Yeah, dude, he let us stay in this place, and he didn't know we were staying there, and neither did we.
Walked up, the deer's just hanging there.
Rapping. You go to YouTube.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's pretty amazing.
And so all his raps, he's like a saner down there in Sitka, and all his stuff is like, all his videos and all his stuff are like.
Is it rapping?
I think it's R-A-P-P-I-N, and then Captain.
Rapping Captain?
A-I-N. And just, no hook. Now hit that and search, let's see. Oh man!
Write like Fisherman or something with that, or Sitka or something.
Itka, maybe Sitka.
Let's see. Oh man!
Well, there's Sydney. Boy. Yeah, go fishing. Put in fishing too. Man, what was his song he had? He had one that like blew up big time.
Yeah.
Captain, the Sitka special. Scroll down.
It's crazy. It's not pulling any of his shit up.
Maybe he took it down.
Maybe.
Man, it was amazing.
Well, that's too bad.
His stuff was like spoof. Like, what's the word? Not spoof, but...
What the hell, man? I
think it's called like a spoof, right? Where you?
Yeah.
What was the stuff that...
Weird Al Yankovic.
Yeah. Was that spoof? Right. No, there's another word for that.
Parody?
Parody.
Oh, yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Was this parody?
Yeah. Yeah, it was parody for sure.
Rapping, capping, parody.
Yeah.
Parody. I'm
going to search.
No, we can't find it. Well, if you find it, we'll put it up and we'll link it to this thing so we can let people listen to it.
Yeah.
Because I want people to hear that. It's hilarious. And it's good. Like, he's a really good rapper, actually.
It's a recognizable beat and song behind it, isn't it?
Yeah, totally.
Damn.
Yeah, he like redid the, I don't know, like the Migos or something like.
Yeah.
One of those songs, like I want to say. Man, maybe he took it down. Who knows? We'll see if you can find it, Jack.
Yeah.
Anyway, Patreon, anyway. You can listen to this episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no sponsors. There's no none of that at that point.
There's no ad reads. There's no nothing on the Patreon.
That was the underground podcast.
Yeah. Actually, you should probably see what we've said on those.
So I'm assuming you listen to that first. You're just testing out the equipment. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
Is it there?
Yeah. So search fishing without the G and then a space problem.
Problem.
And then write AK natural in one word.
Problem.
Oh, AK natural is his thing. That's right.
Fishing problem.
Fishing problem by AK natural and then YouTube. One word, AK natural.
I mean, I should.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Find it. There it is.
Can you get some volume on that?
Oh, I'd have to Bluetooth.
Oh.
So I can. I can't. Hold on. I'll pause it and we'll go back to it here in a minute. We have to listen to this.
I think the Mickey Five's in this.
we absolutely have to listen to this.
Go to your. Did you put your Bluetooth on?
I'm working on it.
You should be able to connect to the straight to the Roadcaster.
Yeah, Courtney Howard.
Yeah. Oh, bait it, set it, haul it. I think that's the one. Which one's the most popular? Bait it, set it, haul it. Yeah, maybe that. Okay. Is your Bluetooth on?
I'm connected to it, it says.
To the Roadcaster?
Yeah.
All right, press play.
Okay. You hear it?
Is the volume up on yours?
Yeah. No, the volume's up. Oh, it is up.
We got to hear it.
See about your system volume.
New to the Mac, boys.
It should be on the top right. There should be like a volume.
Got it.
No, you're not connected to Bluetooth.
It's not, huh?
No.
Okay.
Oh, he made some brownies in that. Okay.
Oh, remember his brownies were legit, dude. Up.
They were super good brownies. Yeah.
His brownies are real good.
Yeah, the hospitality, man. He's an awesome guy.
Oh, it is paired to your thing, yeah, Brandon. I mean,
that's what I'm saying.
Nice.
Says it is. You guys.
All right, press play again. Is it in our headphones?
No.
It's in the TV.
Yeah, TV.
Oh, maybe because you're connected to the TV too. That's weird. Well, disconnect. Maybe I'll connect.
Well, why don't you just pull up the video on your phone?
Well, if I connect them on this thing. Oh, people listening?
Yeah.
Just watch it on your own time.
No, I'm saying. You hook up to it.
That's what I'm saying. You have to disconnect from the Bluetooth, though.
But you can.
I got you.
You can go to Courtney Howard on YouTube and watch all these.
I disconnected you.
Okay, good. Not connected.
This went far left, guys. Sorry. Yeah.
Matt, we are.
I'm invested in this point.
We are allegedly professionals, and just get on for the ride, bro.
Yeah, no, I cannot hear it at this point. Like, I gotta hear it.
No, I mean that's like we're invested in this 100%.
Yeah.
Tap broadcaster.
Yeah.
Why doesn't it pull it up on my thing?
And then we can take the moment to.
I'm still hooked up on the screen, so you'd have to just do the sound.
No, yeah, I will.
Find so like one of these it. Has like a million views, I think.
Yeah, I think it was that bait it, set it one.
That one was over there. It has 10,000 views. We'd have to scroll down.
This is the one that I recognize when he's in the boat and he's making the brownies and shit. This is the one that I know of. Because fishermen make brownies. Okay. They have ovens on their boats.
Go do bait it, set it one.
So go back.
Oh, there you go.
This is the turf. I bring the fish to the turf. Out of the surf. Work. This is my church. I'm always getting the urge. First, I ain't the first. Give me the cash. I'm in the aft. Standing on top of the last. Spaz in 300 fathoms. Running a gap. Just to get cussed by the captain. Send an assassin. Working Alaskan. Find me wherever they catching. I started fishing and I caught the itching. Now every day I'm out there scratching. Got my own ship. I ain't no bitch. I ain't gonna work for a fraction. Less is equipment. A stick for the jit. And we fishing in fashion. Fishing it fast. And lifting the hatch. And pitching. Wet, splashing the deck. Getting the money is easy as catching a sweat. Cucumbers, no Coca-Cola. I ain't a motorboater. I'm just a quota holder. Sporting more numbers than a Motorola. Hit it, set it, holl it. Put a pit check in my wallet. Yeah, hit it, set it, holl it. Put a pit check in my wallet.
I don't think this is the video.
Set it, holl it. Put a pit check in my wallet. Yeah, hit it, set it, holl it. Put a pit check in my wallet. Got all the pounds, headed to town. Feet on the sound, feet on the ground. Waiting the round, none of it flounder. Add an amount to pad the account. Ask my accountant, that's an encounter. Over the counter, passing a check. Even the doubters give me respect. Bigger the yard, the bigger I get.
Fishing the rapping capping.
Fishing my soul, plus fishing my flesh. Fishing a roll.
Sounds really good, dude.
Fishing as bold as anyone's guess. Guess I'm a flex. Guess I'm a set and get fished to kiss to death. Then pitch to catch and go and get some rest. So I can catch my breath and go and get the rest. Beat it, set it, holl it.
Hey, better elevate.
Bait it, set it, holl it.
Coming at you, coming at you.
Bait it, set it, holl it.
Put eat that fucking fish.
There's that spoofy shit, right? I feel like it's more like Lil Dicky type shit.
Yeah, how's that feeling?
Yeah.
Wet from the spray, boy, ain't no punk. Bait it, set it, holl it.
Shit takes a skill though, doesn't it?
All right, that was good. Oh, AK yeah. Natural, YouTube. AK Natural, all one word. Go to his thing.
It actually had a really good beat.
Yeah.
No, it was
super
good.
Catchy.
Yeah,
that was awesome. Man. Yeah. Back to nice the regular plug. Scheduled program here.
And Matt Crowe, what left. Do you do for a living?
Bait it, set it.
Yeah, what brought you to Alaska, man?
Yeah, so I grew up in Minnesota, and then I went to a small private school in Wisconsin for college. And I was a freshman, and then I met this girl who's a senior, and she was from Kenai, Alaska.
You should never date seniors when you're a freshman.
Hey, I mean, I was doing it, man. Everybody said that, and you know, and all the seniors were like, "Oh, no, don't date the freshman." But you know, I was rolling with it, you know.
Oh yeah.
So, but yeah, so we got together, and she moved back to Alaska, and I'm like, "This girl is one in a million. Like, this is it."
Hell yeah.
And so I was, she's like, "Well, you know, my family's in Alaska. I'm moving back." And actually, to go back a little bit. When I first met her, we kind of liked each other, you know, it was kind of doing the dating thing, but then the summertime came.
Yeah.
And we still weren't officially dating. We're, you know, going back and forth. And then, you know, people can, you know, like the thirst traps, you know, people post thirst traps on Instagram.
Oh yeah.
Well, she knew how to give me, because I was sitting there, it was summer break, I'm scrolling Instagram, and it was the fall time, right? We were going to come back to school. And she posts a picture holding this gigantic buck coho. And I was scrolling. I was like, "Ooh!" I was like, "Wait a minute!" I liked it. Yeah, so I immediately texted her. I said, "Hey, how's it going? Can't wait to see you at school." And then she wrote back was, "You liked the picture of my fish, didn't you?"
Maybe.
So, yeah. So that's the only reason I'm here is the coho salmon. That's what got me. But no, we started dating and. Back then, so I guided in Minnesota, and so I had my guide license, and I was like, okay, I got to move to Alaska, but I need a job. And so I didn't know what to do, and so it was springtime of the year. I was like, I got to get a job. So back in the day, I went on Craigslist. Like right now, you feel like you'd get murdered or something, but I got on Craigslist, and for some reason, I watched a show about halibut fishing. And so then I was like, okay, I think I can... you know, be a deckhand on a halibut charter.
Oh, yeah.
And I pulled that off. And so I went on Craigslist, and I saw all these ads for Homer, you know, halibut charter. So I just shot off a bunch of resumes, didn't hear anything, and then shout out Official Charters of Alaska. Chad Matthews hit me back and was like, "Hey, like, we just took over this business. You're hired." And I had an old stepside Chevy that wasn't going to make the drive. So he calls me up. He's like, "Can you be here?" And I think it was like 2 weeks or something like that. I was like, "Yeah, absolutely." Hung up the phone. I called up my buddy. I'm like, "My truck's not going to make it. Can I trade you my truck for your Blazer?" It had a little few less miles on it. So he's like, "Yeah." So I got the Blazer. And then I think I just Googled some like primary towns on the Alcan. And I just took off. I didn't even plan nothing. I just hopped in the Blazer, started driving, and... yeah, didn't plan out anything, but yeah, just got up here, started working on halibut charters, and
straight to Homer.
Yeah, straight to Homer.
How'd you do in the salt?
Salt was good, man. I liked the salt. It was obviously new, coming from the Midwest, you know.
Yeah.
But never got seasick, you know. It was fun, man.
That's good.
Homer will do that to you, though. Homer's made me sick the most ever.
Yeah, yeah. It's just,
I don't know what
it was. Always those days where it was like, you know, it was a. Like a storm was a couple of days ago, so there's still those long rollers evening out, stuff like that. I feel bad. People pay for like a long range charter out to like the Barren Islands or something, and they're just puking in a bucket all day long, you know? Yeah. Yeah, but we specialized in long range halibut charters, so yeah, a lot of those big old butts.
Yeah.
What was the
biggest one you guys ever got?
We weren't getting a huge. Ours was just shy of 200. The biggest one we had. But we would tell. That was back when they did the Derby, and we would tell folks when they got on the boat, we're like, you know, if you got a Derby ticket, and it's over 100, like we might bonk it. But if it's over 100, you don't have a Derby ticket, it's going back 100%. Like we weren't killing the big girls. Yeah. We're letting them spawn. Yep. Yeah.
That was like a rule, captain's rule.
Yep, captain. We told them up front, so they stepped on the boat. We're like, we don't kill big girls. No.
Yeah.
And
then from there, what?
Yeah, so from there, it gets a little squirrely, man. Like, I got off the halibut charters, and I kind of, for some odd reason, I somehow ended up in the medical field. So I took a little class to be a ETT, which is like below a EMT.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did that, and then I kind of transitioned into a full-time respiratory gig, and then I kind of started school for respiratory therapy, started doing that, And then I realized that it just wasn't, it wasn't for me.
And what does that entail?
So that? There's lots of aspects of it, but it entails, they can be multiple different things. So like oxygen therapy. So for people who have like end of life or COPD, sleep therapy, like CPAPs, BiPAPs for obstructive sleep apnea, and then vents, which is basically life support kind of stuff. So like hooking it. Yeah. You got a trach and all that kind of stuff. Yeah.
The CPAP, is that like a real popular?
Yeah. Yeah. CPAP, continuous positive airway pressure. So that's when you get the mask on, you turn on the little machine, it blows air in your face to keep your, to keep the butt muscle in the back.
You have some music playing still or something?
Do we got Captain, yeah, Captain Raps a lot still going?
Was it on the TV? Is that where
we're, I think it was what you just closed.
Yeah.
Hold on. Let's be quiet for a second.
Well, I'm starting to, like, I know almost every other dude I know has a CPAP.
It's super learn. Common. Yeah, oh, yeah, it's like, crazy common.
And I'm pretty sure I'm a candidate. Like, I'm, yeah. Oh, man.
Oh, 100% you're a candidate.
Do you wake up feeling tired?
Not like so much.
Okay.
I mean, I feel like I have goods and bad nights. I think when I snore real, real bad, I'm not. I'd say if there's 7 days in a week, 5 nights, I get pretty good sleep.
Okay.
You know, I don't. Yeah.
Does anybody?
You get good sleep.
Yeah. If you're feeling it.
The CPAP's for everyone else.
Yeah, right. That's very true, man.
Yeah. Do they have the?
Thank you for pointing that out.
PAP.
Ooh.
Sheep PAP. I had a lot of guys ask me, like, I'm going on a hunting trip. Can I take this with me? And so they make like little alligator clips, and you can put them to like a 12 volt battery and take them fishing and hunting and stuff like that. So people take them.
Yeah, I mean, I hear guys traveling with them to hotels.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or bring them in their suitcase or have their own kit or whatever.
This reminds me, dude. I went to this conference in Juneau, and they paired us up. It's like mostly all women, and so they paired like two dudes, me and some other dude I never met from like, went to Juneau, and he was from Fairbanks or something, and he rolls in. He's a really cool dude. He's like, oh, man, we went and had a good night. And at the end of the night, he pulls in and says, hey, man, I meant to tell you I brought this, but. I brought this for you. I was like, what? And he pulls out this suitcase. And it's the whole machine, plugs it in, full thing. I was like, dang.
Darth Vader shit.
He's like, don't worry. You're going to sleep good tonight.
This is going to be quiet up
there. Oh, man. It was this major contraption, though. It looks like it's crazy.
They're kind of like a white noise machine almost. Yeah. When we're not wearing it, you hear it. Yeah, because I've had like hunting buddies where they turn it on. It's kind of nice, like, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah. And it keeps them from snoring. So, yeah. Hey, that's good.
Yeah. John now needs that.
But it was a whole like suitcase.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah. It's like a pack thing. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the little machines, like, you know, they could be this big.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I bet they'll get better with them and make them smaller.
They're getting small. They make mini ones. They make travel ones. Or yeah. Like the teeny little ones. Yeah.
Do they really?
Yeah, little portable ones.
Like the short battery life and
that kind little, of thing? Yeah, or you can actually plug them in too. So okay. If you do want to like fly with them, or I had like a Harley guy, he would like put in his little side saddle bag, you know, go cross country, you know.
I can only imagine once you start doing that like therapeutic sleep shit where you adapt to the CPAP and the breathing and the contraption, so you only roll over certain ways. And I imagine when you get set to that, you can't just go cold turkey and go on a camping trip and be like, no, I don't have my CPAP. I got to go back. Yeah, like these dudes are taking generators and shit up to their moose camp.
Oh, yeah.
For their CPAP.
So Kayla can run a CPAP in moose camp.
Oh, in your camp?
No, not at our camp, but their moose camp. They haul a generator, and so they can have lights. But it's really for.
I bet all four of you boys could plug into that thing.
Oh, I mean, I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, okay, that makes sense. I can live without a generator on so many levels, but if you were just a dude that was a chronic snorer, which I am, and you weren't living that life for, say, 9 months straight, you know, you get plugged onto a, you know, hung over on a cot. At a bad angle, just
scaring
you guys already
out.
Know, right?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I know.
Oh, yeah.
I know.
All you need is a sleep study now, buddy.
No, but you know, actually,
I'm
on another note,
sure I'm official.
For more travel wise, I was talking to Steven Peters, and he uses the mouth guard, and he says it works really good.
Okay.
He says he's like, I had to, like, his girl was gonna leave him.
Yeah,
yeah. It's just a mouth guard.
Yeah, it's a mouth guard, and it makes his like lower jaw
set your jaw
out. and it just opens the passageway. Yeah. Says it works really good. Wow. Says his jaw did hurt like for a couple of days the first time because he got used to being in that weird position.
Yeah.
But he says now it's like he has to have it.
Wow.
And it's just a mouth guard.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool.
He brought it to Homer, which was, you know, nice. Yeah.
He didn't snore.
For everybody else that.
He ended up sleeping in a different room, so I didn't hear. But it's real nice of him.
Checking
them
out.
That one right there, the blue. Yeah. No. To the right.
Well, that's the comfort blue. That's,
the new anti snoring nice chin strap. That's what you need, B.
Chin strap. Yeah.
That looks transportable.
That's for people who use a nasal mask, and so they have to keep their mouth shut so the air goes into their nose. So you relax, open your mouth, then the air just goes in your nose, out your mouth, and then you wake up with a cotton mouth. So some people physically just.
Strap it down.
Chin strap. Strap that mouth shut.
I don't want to feel like I'm going to jail when I go to sleep, man.
Yeah.
what a preparation.
Yeah.
It's not attractive. It's
no, yeah, dude. No,
okay, honey.
It's so uncomfortable.
Put Matt, my chin strap on. Do you have any sort of sleep?
No.
You're good?
Yeah, my wife says that I'll the classic signs of sleep apnea, like I'll stop breathing for like a second, go like wake myself up. Yeah. So, but I mean, I always seem kind of rested. I mean, I never sleep anyway. I'm always doing something, so I don't really sleep in general. So,
I don't think that's what I'm doing. Actually, what you
yeah, that is what you're doing.
Yeah, you just constantly go.
Yeah, I think that's the app. Get a nap here and there, and just.
But you can't use those and be like a stomach sleeper.
Oh yes, yeah, I'm a stomach sleeper. I can't. I couldn't use one of them.
Yeah. I do the breathe right strips.
Oh yeah, those are nice.
Yeah.
That works okay.
They're okay. Yeah. I'm thinking that with the mouthpiece.
Yeah, you'll be good. And the chin strap.
You're going to get the whole apparatus. Darth Vader, we call it. We call it Darth Vader.
Yeah. What I don't want is the CPAP, and what I don't want is the deviated septum surgery.
That's not bad. Okay. I had that. And I can smell stuff, breathe stuff. I mean, it was amazing.
Oh, man, you're the only maybe person.
Tangy and Freshy both got it after me from the same doctor. And the one doctor that does it up here, she went to like a fellowship for it, and she's the one. She's the one you go to. She's really good.
Okay.
Well, this is encouraging.
Who else got it?
Tangy and Freshy. Remember, Freshy got hit with that hockey puck and broke his nose?
Oh, yeah.
And then after Freshy and I could smell cider, then Tangy was like, oh, shit, I need to be able to smell cider too.
Freshy got it, Tangy got it too, huh?
Yep. We all had the same person. Awesome. And she'll be like, I'll give you whatever nose you want too. And I was like, I just want my regular nose.
What do you mean?
Oh, like reconstruction of your nose?
Of the bone in there? So she can like reshape.
You could be like, oh, I want, you know, a B Hollywood actor nose. And boom, she'll give you that one.
But not
plastic. She showed me pictures. It's like, no, it's like, because the surgery she does is partially plastic. So so she can do that.
And you just decided to stick with that?
She was showing me pictures right before I went under. I was like, nope. And she's like, this one. I was like, what's your favorite one? And she showed me some like B actor guy I'd never seen. I was like, I don't want it. Yeah.
Did any of the other boys get it?
No, none of the other ones. You'd have to ask Justin, but CJ's brother had his done in Colombia, and they asked him the same thing, and he said no, and they did it, and they gave him like a Hollywood actor nose.
Whoa.
Did he like it, though?
Yeah, he loves it.
Yeah. They're like, trust me, you're going to want this when you wake up.
Yeah. Alex isn't be mad at me, but
I've heard the horror stories.
He looks good.
Yeah. I've heard the horror stories.
Oh, it's amazing, man.
Like the bleeding and the nosebleeds and the
You can do stuff for a while. You had like, then you have stuff up in your nose for a while.
Yeah, it was like one week or so, and I couldn't play hockey for two or something.
Well, I've heard of it coming back, like the deviation reshapes itself, and then you kind of go. I don't want to say like back to where it was, but it.
I think that it depends what it is, and there's different things they do for different types of problems. The problem for, I think, a lot of the people and why she's so good is since she had this fellowship, she can also do the plastic surgery, and a lot of it is like when you try to breathe in really hard and like plug one part of your nose, it'll collapse the other side. Well, that's cartilage that's holding it out, and you need more cartilage grafted, and that's plastic surgery. So people are doing the surgery without that. You're not going to have the strength. Well, they were carving too much stuff. They were carving or changing the pathway or whatever, but not providing the strength on the outside of the cartilage.
Oh, so it would just collapse outside back of the down.
Nose. Yeah. And so this person does that.
That's what's happening with these dudes, because that's exactly what it sounds like they're experiencing.
Yeah. So anyway, she's really, really good.
Did she do the lips too?
My lips? I didn't know my lips looked that good, but so hard thank you. Dude. Thank you very much.
Oh, they look nice.
I didn't so know they were so nice.
And back to Matt. All
right. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Well, you started it. You started.
Yeah, bro. I didn't think I was going to get the plastic surgery.
I mean, but, I just asked a question. Yeah. You answered it well. We just curveballed the shit out of the damn thing.
It's all good.
So then what? What happened after?
So I got in the medical field. I just realized, you know, it wasn't for me, and I'm just a backwoods bumpkin. I'm like, I need to give back.
Minnesota?
So I was like, I need to get back to, you know, the outdoor industry and stuff. So I applied at University of Alaska Southeast for their fisheries program. And so got in.
That's where the rap and capping went.
Oh, there we go. So I missed my opportunity. Could have gone with them. But
you're the captain at the beginning of the song. You fucking idiots.
Eat that fish.
That's Sitka? The guy who's from Sitka?
Yeah.
Go, Matt. Go.
But yeah, no. So I graduated from there, and I got my first official job in fisheries was working for ADF&G in Kenai on the Chinook sonar program. So that was super cool. Yeah. I mean, I was a kid in a candy store. Like,
it was boring.
Two. Anybody else is probably crazy boring, but I had a full-on, like, log book on the side of, like, my actual work.
It was very important.
And I was, like, documenting everything. My boss had to tell me, it's like, hey, like, you know, like, pick it up. You don't have to document everything. But I wanted to know, like, for past or future reference, like, every single fish that was coming in and what time of day so I could, you know,
fish them. Yeah.
You named them?
Yeah, right.
So were you up on the hill there or
no? So actually the it's on River Mile 14 on the lower Kenai, and there's four main river sonars, and there's a back channel, so there's one more sonar back there. Mm-hmm. And then there's like a little tent campsite, and so we would go out to the tent, and then there's like little memory drives. Mm-hmm. And that's where we would collect all the data. And we'd take it back to the ADF&G office and then plug it in, download it, and then count it.
14, okay. Is that like Centennial-ish?
That's down, you know where River Bend Resort is?
Off of Kenai Spur.
You know where Big Eddy? Just down around from around the corner, downstream from Big Eddy.
So that's up above Pillars?
Yeah.
That's still technically lower?
Yeah, that's lower.
Where's the lower marker?
Lower marker?
What makes it lower?
Isn't the lower marker like the Solano?
I thought it was the bridge.
The bridge, yeah. And then from that is like technically middle.
Yeah.
Boulder Garden up there, yeah.
Okay, then it goes into Bings and all that.
Yep, Bings middle. Goes past the Naptown Rapids up into Bings.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So the bridge down.
So yep, how do you tell the difference between like a king and a red on the sonar?
So there's a measuring criteria.
Uh-huh.
And so I believe every fish had to be 75. I think it was centimeters. Don't quote me on that. I have to look it up. It's been a while. But anyway.
And the sonar can tell how big the fish is.
Oh, yeah. The sonar is crazy. The sonar was actually, if I remember right, it was developed by the military, actually. And then they started using it for fisheries because it was so good. But you can see Chinook when they're, obviously you can measure them when they're on screen. But a Chinook, usually, the sockeye usually come up in pairs. And they're always like really swimming. Mm. When a Chinook comes on the screen, that sucker is big tail sweeps. The center of it's called a sonic dead zone. When the sonar image is shooting out, it'll kind of go dead in the center of the king for whatever reason. They think maybe it has to do with like natural like predatory stuff, like because orcas hunt them and stuff. When you're looking at the king, the center of it looks almost like a dead zone. So size, how it swims, the dead zone, the middle, and usually a king would be main channel of the river by itself.
Mm-hmm.
Sockeye like to swim with little pairs. You see him come up two by two.
Mm-hmm.
Big old king, she's rocking it in the main current about 20 meters out. Yeah, just trucking.
Yeah, it's got its own lane of the river.
Pretty much, yeah. Because, I mean, sockeye, they like to stick right close to the bank. And so you see one that's hugging the bank. And sometimes you catch the king going close. But usually the king's like a main stem. Like going in the main thing. Silvers are typically like the sockeye. They like to hang closer to the bank. Pinks are the crackheads. the paint everywhere. All over the other. Shoot across river, comes right back, goes up, down. Like, there's no, they're just crazy. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah. So you could definitely tell. Energy. Yeah. A lot of people, they go and be like, oh, how can you tell? How can you tell on count? It can't be that accurate. And it's like, we'll go into the office. Yeah. Like, you cannot know what you're doing, and you know it's a king.
How, so how you about, count them individually?
Oh, yeah. Yep. Yeah. You count them. You, so you, it's a little cursor. You put them on the measuring, and then you hit F for fish, and then it counts it.
And that goes for all the reds too?
No. So in the very early on, like in May, like some of the Russian River reds would trickle in,
mm-hmm.
and we count them for like a little while to kind of give the Russian River guys like a heads up and the estimate, kind of what's coming. But after, like, you know, when the main push of reds come, that's a separate sonar. So there's an actually group of guys who only count reds, and we were the Chinook side counting.
Oh, gotcha.
Counting
the Chinook. And they have to count them like that?
Is yeah.
Like a digital counter?
Yeah, for us, it was, a one-by-one king. The red guys, I don't want to speak for them, do misinformation. You have to reach out to them. But yeah.
Probably just count them all minus the kings.
Yeah, I don't know if it's like a numeration thing with the king or with the sockeye or what. But
Does big trout, does trout or anything come up?
I was going to ask dollies and like steelhead.
Yeah, early in the year when we were counting, kind of around the time, you would see a fish, like, you know, it wasn't a sockeye. And it was small enough. It definitely wasn't king. So you're like, yeah, what is this? I would think maybe it was some kind of native fish or rainbow or dolly, you know?
Yeah.
Okay. That was kind of like reddish sized.
Yeah.
But it was, not the big king, like you said earlier, with the big
Yeah, it was more. And you could tell, like, the reds, they were a little thicker. This thing was more like slender. Mm. You know, you could tell.
Mm-hmm. A sea run dolly of some sort.
Yeah, something like that. Or, you know. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, no, it was cool.
Man, I've never heard.
Yeah.
The breakdown of how it works.
It's awesome.
Yeah, no, definitely.
I've always wondered, and you go down to that river and you hear those numbers and you think about what goes into the process. Yeah, and I've seen the setups on the Deshka.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's probably something similar, but the Kenai is a whole other animal. So
we would use Aris sound metrics with our sonar. They used to use, like, was it Ditson or something like that? It was an older style, but the Aris sound metrics are amazing. And you can actually look it up online. If you Google the Kenai Chinook King Salmon Sonar Project, there's a whole, like, PDF file of where the sonars are, how we measure, where they are, everything.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So anybody who has a question about it, it's like, oh, how can you tell, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
They get list out in detail what all we do.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah,
and you can stop. I'm pretty sure you might want to ask first, but I'm pretty sure they'd be open to, call them and
go check
coming
it out.
On in, see how they do it. Yeah. Yeah, it's not a big secretive smoke and mirrors thing that people think,
not at all.
Yeah.
And it's on the bottom shooting up?
No. So there's going to be four sonars on both sides of the riverbank, and one each. So say we're on the left side of the riverbank. One sonar is going to be shooting kind of like, they call it the near shore sonar. Mm-hmm. So it's only going to shoot out like a short distance. And then there's the far offshore sonar, which is going to shoot clear across the halfway across the river.
Mm.
And then same thing with the other side.
Like crisscrosses.
So you're counting the close fish and the far fish. Mm-hmm. And then the sonars on the other side are shooting. So you cover the whole river by the four sonars. And then the back channel one is just like a little back slew. And so that one's just there just to make sure, like, you know, king's like slipping in. Sometimes they would. Sometimes they would tool in the back slew to slip on the back way and count them. And that was fun because it was so close. You could see everything on the king.
Oh, yeah,
really close.
I bet it got a nice little break going over there.
Slows down. Yeah. Sometimes they just kind of hang there. Yeah. And always really cool. You could see, like a boat would go by, and you could see like the propeller like thing, and then you could see the duck butts when they're swimming on the top of the river. It kind of looks like a little duck butt, little paddles.
Yeah.
And then we'd see seals. They would chase the kings. You see the king just trucking, and the seals would go and like swipe at him and stuff like that. And it was cool.
I've never seen seals in the Kenai. Yes, I have. I take that back.
Oh, they're all over
the Eagle lower. Rock.
Yeah, Eagle Rock. Yeah.
Silvers.
Yeah, no, they're all. Back. Yeah.
I have seen those.
Yeah, they're all the way up to Ski Lake, I heard.
Oh yeah.
Oh really?
Oh, I believe that.
In the dunes, you see them in the dunes. Yeah.
Yeah. Have you ever seen them up the Sioux? The Sioux Sentinel River.
Mm-mm.
Seen them August, end of August, at the Yetna confluence.
With the Susitna?
With the Susitna, with the big sandbars. I've seen 20 of them laying on there in the sun.
Man. Wow.
All upside down with their bellies out.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I'm like, I mean, I've seen them all the way up to the Deshka too.
Yeah, they're crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And after Kings, I mean, that's pretty wild how far they'll travel in fresh water like that.
I know. Yeah.
Must be a really great food source.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, especially on the lower. I mean, those things are fat and happy. God. Like, they're just, yeah.
A seal getting a 50-pound king?
Yeah.
Damn, I saw
a lot of them. A lot of them missed, though. Like, I thought, I'm sure. I thought it was, like, a king being so big that those things would just wreck them. But
yeah.
From what I saw, they would definitely swipe at them, and that's when you see, like, you know, the big cut on the side. So they, but they're pretty wily. Like, you could tell they made it. But
wow. Then what?
So from there, I finished out that season, and kind of halfway into this, I had been like a hobby rod builder, or whatever, and so I started Alaska Rod Co. as a hobby, and then at that point, when my season ended at ADF&G, I really started getting in the rods full time, and then by the time it came back for, because it was a seasonal position, it came back the next season, my boss was like, hey, like, you come back to the seminar. And I kicked it around. I finally messaged him. I was like, I can't swing it. Like, I can't commit to two things at once because I didn't have time to do either or. So I just went full in on the rods.
Nice.
Whoa, awesome. Yeah, hold on. Back up.
Yeah.
That's great that you got into the rod thing. Mm-hmm. But when did you build a rod? What spurred? I'm going to build my own rod, and I caught my first fish, and I'm going to make a business. Where did that happen?
So the rod building journey got to me just from rod repair. It's like, it's growing up, it was just, I mean, because my dad was a guide, so we had like 30, 40 old rods sitting around all the time, you know, guides popping off, tips snapping.
And everything needed maintenance all the time. Exactly. Right?
So you learned how to wind the guides on and everything. And then, so that's where I kind of like started getting it. Okay, I'll repair the rod. And then it was about 2019. When I was like, okay, you know what? Like, I was getting into spey fishing. I like spey fishing. So I was like, you know, instead of just dinking around, kind of like adding parts to my stuff, I'm going to make a full spey rod. So I ordered all the stuff. It was cheap China junk, all the parts, but I rolled that thing and it was like holding my newborn. Oh, I picked that spey rod up off the lathe and I was like, this is it. The thing was a polished turd, but as soon as I picked it up, I was like,
"It's my baby.
I love this. You know, I'm not into tying flies and all this kind of stuff. Before that, it was just fishing was my hobby, but I don't know. It was just like, it's like hitting a drug. As soon as I picked it up, I was like, this is it. And so, and I wanted to, you know, do it full time eventually. And so I was like, you know, there's guys out there been building rods for 40 years. So I was like, well, you know, how am I ever going to get to this?
How do you compete with that, right?
Yeah. So I was like, so if I'm going to do it, and it was easy for me because I was so addicted to it, but I just started to do it over and over and over. I would go to bed, I would lay at night and just think, I want to be out there building that rod. And I just did it over, and a few hundred times later, I finally felt like I got up to the professional quality level and just kept going.
Wow.
Yeah.
How many rods do you think you built now?
I know it's not in the thousands, but it's the high triples. I know that, but I wouldn't say it's in the thousands yet. But
man, that's cool.
Yeah. That is cool.
Yeah.
What a high though, huh?
Oh,
it's high. Just to like feel like you struck something that you're like, wait, maybe I could do something with this, right?
It was the first time that and going back to when I first started out. So going back to how Alaska Rod Co. kind of started. I really liked the name Alaska Rod Co. I was like, yeah, because everybody's got like, you know, this custom rods or, you know, Matt. So I could have just made a Crow custom rods. That was kind of good.
Yeah.
But I was like, Alaska doesn't have its own brand. And because I was fishing on the anchor and I broke my favorite fly rod and I had to send it out to the lower 48 to get repaired. And I was like, well, this kind of sucks. I'm like, I'll just go buy a rod from Alaska. Googled it. Nothing. I was like, there's no rod companies here. And I reached out to some manufacturers at the time. Like, hey, would you ever consider making a special line for Alaska for all of us up here so we wouldn't have to do all this stuff?
Yeah.
And it was always like, oh, no, we got a situation here, whatever. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to do it. So I went on social media. I started the name Alaska Rod Co. and just kind of forgot about it. And then all of a sudden people randomly started finding it. and they didn't even know the rods. They started messaging me and say, hey, can we get a rod from you?
Like, they just want to try something new.
Yeah, and I was like, can we get a rod from you? And I was like, oh, you know, I'm still, like, researching out and everything, you know. And so I was like, okay. And then what really hit me is I started, like, piddling. That, like, I was at that point where nothing I did I felt was perfect enough. I'm kind of a perfectionist in that way. And and a guy called me and said, can I get 20 of your rods for my season?
Oh, wow.
And I was like, wait a minute. Yeah. There might be something to this. Like, people want these rods. And I was still hesitant. And my wife said to me, she's like, people want these rods, and you're ready. And I just kept saying, no, I'm not ready. And then she said, okay. She's like, you're coming with me. So she took me to the nearest fly shop. She handed me the most expensive rod in that shop. She said, here you go. Brand X, $950. Compare it to yours. I said, oh, yeah, well, this thing, you know, epoxy's not as straight. The stripper's off kilter. You know, it's not spying correctly. Started going, yeah, yeah. She's like, yeah. It's like, your rods are good. They're any bit as good as this. She's like, you can do it. So she pushed me, and it just kind of snowballed what it is.
That's a great story.
Yeah, nice plug, dude.
Yeah. Plug
for the wife.
I wouldn't be here in Alaska if it wasn't for her, and Alaska Rodco wouldn't be a thing if it wasn't for her.
Well, and it seems, I mean, if I'm just being honest, as an Alaskan guy,
yeah,
Alaska something has got a lot of names. Like Alaska, where he plugs AK this, 907 that, yeah, Alaska this.
Alaska Wild Project.
Alaska Wild Project. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. But to your point, no one makes it like
that's
exclusive.
Crazy that no one does that.
I mean, nobody did it.
Yeah. That must have been kind of like, what? Really? Like,
yeah, I was just
shocked. Some old dude from the 70s isn't making rods somewhere?
Yeah, and then there was like some.
And there
like
are guys that are
custom
doing
guys.
It.
Yeah. But I got this vision for like R.O. Winston. Montana has R.O. Winston.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Scott has, you know, Colorado. I was like, where's our representation? You know, like, Alaska's such a tight knit, just cool bunch of fisher people, you know? I'm like, you know what? Like, it'd be cool if we could have our own brand, you know? Yeah. And so that's just how it spiraled, and, you know, and that's what pushes me for the quality aspect, too, because, like, if it bears the name Alaska, it's got to be top tier.
And as much as, like, you know, we bring up anything, like, COVID-related, it feels like you say 2019.
Yeah.
So rolling forward, there's, like, 2 years where you probably had shit tons of bench time.
Mm-hmm.
And you could just build rods during the quarantine time if you had a bunch of materials, right?
Yeah, well, it was kind of a blessing in disguise that I started around that time, because as of that time, so many companies were getting stuff overseas, and then
they couldn't.
Yeah, I hit the fan, and then there was
production goes to hell.
Production went to hell, and so I learned right away. I'm like, I'm not putting out a whole bunch of rods, and then people step on them. Their dog breaks it, and it's, you know, a month out.
Yeah.
Like, that's our whole fishing season.
Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, so if I make a rod, it's expensive to do this way, but if I make you a rod, you buy it, I build a clone, I hold it. And I try and kind of keep, like, double inventory almost. Oh, so you get an oopsie, then it's here's your tip. You know? So I try and keep ahead of everything like that. And it's, you know, as I get bigger and bigger, you just keep scaling up. But that's kind of how you got to swing it, because you never know what the economy is going to do, all this kind of stuff. So that's kind of how you got to play it. And that's kind of how I learned it in the pandemic, you know?
Well, yeah. When you said 2019, I'm like, oh, man, if you're starting a hobby where you need to invest time in something, it was a great opportunity, like building a business or developing a podcast or whatever. Yeah,
there's so many businesses in 2020.
You're really another really cool story of what it's like birthed from a tilt time where you're like, go full send in it.
Yep.
I have time to do it. And then now here you pop out 2 years later and shit's rolling, right?
Yeah. It was crazy. And I didn't expect the amount of like community that came out for it too. And I
just, that's the coolest
support
part
local,
about it.
Man. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Alaska. Sure.
That chokes me up a little bit.
Support,
man.
You get Alaska supports each other, man. It's so nice. Yeah. So beautiful that Alaska does that.
I tell people all the time, I could start Iowa Rod Company. Nobody would have cared.
Yeah.
But it was just the amount of people who showed up and just didn't know me from Adam. It was like, hey, let me take pictures of your rods for you. Here you go. Just totally free. You know, just here's for advertisement or your website. Yeah. Or let me help you with your website. Or let me go demo this rod for you and stuff like that. And it was just and just an overwhelming.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so that's what kind of got me too for the quality. I'm like, I'm rolling rods for these people. Yeah. Like they gotta be Alaskan.
Mm. Yeah. So you were talking about earlier off camera, but like your turnaround, like on your warranty, what's that look like?
Yep. So warranty typically would be about a week. You know, if things are getting pretty crazy and hectic, I like to tell people 1 to 2 weeks, but I try and keep it within a 1 week turnaround time.
Yeah.
Because nobody wants to do that.
No.
Nobody wants to bust a rod and then, you know,
so
sit around with it.
That Jake swung in the cider today, and he had told me he just dropped off his Sage that he broke to go get fixed. He wants to use it on our fishing trip we have coming up, and they told him 18 weeks.
What?
18.
A year and a half?
At a local shop here in Alaska? Or
no, you have to send it back to the manufacturer. Mm. You know, but Sage was like one of these companies, like growing up, that, man, you broke it, you send it in right away. It was free for that to fix it. Now you pay for shipping and there's a fee to fix it. But it, you know, we were like, man, it would be so awesome if we could have someone local. And I told them, you know, what we're going to talk about tonight. So we'll learn some more. But as all Alaskan, like you have like such a short window to fish, you know? Yeah. And, you know, you're getting into like the middle of summer and got 18 weeks, you know, or you got, you know, 1 week. Good quality.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And with like Alaska too, like you're going on a fishing trip, like you fly all the way down to like the Aleutians or something like that. Like you're taking that sucker way out there. And so you're going to want to trust that rod too. Like warranty is one thing, but making sure that you're pouring your heart and soul and you're testing the fire, I think before you ship it to the customer.
Yeah.
Because I mean, that would just be the biggest letdown. Oh, you man. Get out to like world class or Bristol Bay, and
trip
out there
of a lifetime.
Oh, just bust it off.
Rod just falls apart.
Exactly. Nobody wants to fish backup rods. They used to have backup TFOs and stuff like that. It's like nobody wants to like bust out the backup rod first
day.
No
way, man.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those turn into kid rods.
Yeah.
Yeah, they do.
They will be kid rods.
They love them, though.
Oh, yeah, dude. Backup rods. Oh, man, you better be ready for them to snap that thing, step on that thing. Oh, man.
Just a good old ugly stick with an ambassador on it.
You have good old ugly stick.
My youngest doesn't even have the tip on it. You don't know.
You just
cut it. Cut it back.
Took some dikes and just cleaned it.
Yeah. Let's take a quick break. We'll come back and do trivia, and then I want to do the full nerd out on the process of making these rods.
Cool.
And
hell yeah.
And all the different kinds that you got too.
Tailored Restoration, 24-hour emergency home services, helping Alaskans restore their dreams since 1972. Services include fire, water, mold, post-emergency cleaning, repair, and remodeling. Tailored has an emergency response number with trained professionals available to help you at any time, day or night. Give them a call in Anchorage, Eagle River, Matsu, or Fairbanks. Make an appointment today at tailoredrestorationalaska.com. Total Truck and Alaska Overlander, Alaska's premier supplier for custom automotive accessories and overlanding products, providing all-inclusive rental vehicles and trailers custom outfitted to explore the Alaskan backcountry with a unique and convenient traveling experience. At Total Truck, you can find brands such as ARE, RSI Smart Caps, Goose Gear, iCamper, Front Runner, Rigid Lights, Rhino Linings Bedliners, and everything you need to outfit your truck or SUV. Alaska Overlander provides 4x4 vehicles and expedition trailers, custom modified for Alaskan adventures and outfitted with rooftop tents, fridges, and all the camping and cooking gear you need to start exploring. Visit them at AlaskaOverlander.com.
Yeah, there is a left and right there. Alexia, I know what I want for Father's Day. what would you suggest? I want to say the majority. I do have a 9-10. I have an 8.
Okay.
But I want something fancy for trout.
Okay. Where are you fishing the trout?
I would say the majority is Kenai, Willow, Gulkana.
Okay. Are you, like, for the Kenai, are you doing, like, upper Kenai a lot?
Upper
middle,
Kenai.
Middle Kenai? Like, what's your bread and butter?
Upper Kenai mostly because I have a raft. Okay, but I do go with my brother on his boat in the middle. But I would say majority is upper Kenai. Upper.
Okay. And you said you already got a 9.
I got a 9, 10. I got an 8. But like I said, those are, like, I'm ready to, like, pass them down. So yeah, I'm looking for something for me.
Okay. What are you, like, throwing? Are you throwing, like... nymphs, so you're throwing beads?
Mostly beads.
Okay. Yeah,
mostly beads.
Are you fishing from a boat or
from the raft?
You're fishing from the raft.
Okay. Most of it's from the raft.
Do you pull over a lot, or are you fishing actually as you're floating?
I'm fishing as I'm floating.
Okay. Yeah, so for that I would do a 9-6. So 9-6, yeah, fast action. So my 9-6 anadromous. So 9-footers are really nice if you're fishing from the boat, because it's a because for throwing indicators and beads and stuff, a 10-footer is nice to just roll cast it out there. But if you're fishing from a boat, especially a raft, having that longer rod sometimes gets a little goofy when you're trying to net.
Yeah,
and everybody has their preference, but definitely a 9-footer is nice for the raft.
Tight space.
Yeah, tight space. Yeah. You can net it easier. So yeah, a nine six fast action. Well, you know, you can turn over your bead rigs nice. You can throw some meat. Yeah. You know, and it's light enough, delicate enough. You want to throw some nymphs in the spring and stuff like that. You can do that.
Okay.
Yeah, but I would do that 9-footer, 9-6.
Keep that in the back of your mind there.
Yeah.
Now, as far as like customization of them, is the customer able to choose like color combos, or that's like this is your 9?
Yeah, so six, so they are production rods. So I got a whole production. So the anadromous and all them. And so what I want is like everybody that's the Alaska brand, it's their rods. But if you do want something crazy custom like the Van Halen or something like that, you can message me and say, "Hey, like I want this." And then I can produce that. But there is a set production lineup. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Right on. Trivia, Jack?
Oh, we can do some trivia. We need a jingle, though.
Do, 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 do. Should we put the wrapping cap and back on?
Just put that on a button.
Yeah, we need that on a button. On a button. Eat that fish.
Fucking idiot.
Oh, before you go into that, okay, so what would that cost?
So the
traditionally, if someone went to your website.
So $545.
Okay.
Yep, that's $545, lifetime warranty.
All right.
Yeah.
Perfect. Perfect. So like the website's Alaska Rod.
AlaskaRodCo.com.
Or AlaskaRodCo.com.
Yep, yeah. And then you can, I also have a 30-day from the time that your order is fulfilled and gets to you, you can try it before you buy it kind of thing.
Oh, okay.
So 30 days, get it, and you're just like, I paid $545 for this thing, and I hate it.
Yeah.
Then just contact us within that 30 days, and then I'll get you a refund, and you return me the rod.
Nice.
There's nothing worse than fishing an expensive rod you hate.
Yeah. Now, before we get into the trivia, one more question. Sorry, Jack. Yeah. I don't see is any ice fishing rods.
Mm. Oh, boy, you should look at my DMs. Everybody's like, oh, you need to nice fishing rod. And actually, Oliver's got some prototypes that I sent him and stuff
like
that. Okay,
because I was chatting with him.
He mentioned that you had
hooked him up. If there's anybody who's going to test out some ice rods,
he'll test it out for sure. Yeah, that's funny because we were chatting about that because he was coming to town for something. He's like, where do I get the, you know, ice fishing stuff? And I was like, there's a couple places, but there's really actually like a need.
Yeah, so I got the feelers out there, and I'm running some tests and stuff like that. So it's definitely a next year project. But yeah, I bet
B&J Sporting Goods would probably rock the shit out of those rods.
Okay, the ice fishing rods.
Yeah, man, because they have a great ice fishing section, best in Anchorage that I'm aware of.
Yeah, pretty good.
As far as rods, reels, and
is all your stuff direct to consumer from the website, or do you have it in some stores?
No, so I'm at my authorized dealers are Wilderness Way in Soldotna,
okay.
Mountain View Sports, and then Mossy's Fly Shop.
Oh, I'm perfect.
Adding hopefully another one here soon, maybe two.
Okay, right on.
I had one quick question because I got my gears turning when you asked them for the price. So what's like the price point of a high quality upper echelon rod? Like in general for fly fishing, learn me up because I have no idea.
Yeah, so basically, like $545 is going to be like your middle of the road, the kind of higher end kind of deal, and then the high end like Rolls Royce looking things are anywhere from $800 to some are $1,500.
Oh no shit!
Yeah, so some
they go over $1,000.
Oh, easy
for a good fly rod.
Easy
for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you go like Temple Fork or something, it's like 300 or $200 to $300
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, so that that would be like a G Loomis. Lamaglass-y kind
of. Not Lamaglass anymore, but yeah, like G. Loomis, R. O. Winston, Scott.
Okay, you know, LaCroix, or not LaCroix. My bad, guys.
Yeah, St. Croix. Yeah, St. Croix, at Park Falls, Wisconsin. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of like that.
Yeah.
All right.
Yep. And in most of it, the price tag on a fly rod should represent kind of where it's made too. Like if it's overseas, you know, like a lot of like rods produced in China and Korea, those are going to be your $70 to, you know, some are even like $400 there in Korea.
But,
yeah, so it's
still decently built, but
yeah,
decent quality.
Mm-hmm.
So I got my gears turning on it. Sorry, guys. I just didn't know what kind of money guys are throwing at these things.
So you have two tiers in your selection too, right?
Yeah, so my entry level tier is 425.
Yeah.
And that's the Teleos series.
Okay.
And so, but it's, I wouldn't say it's an entry level rod because they're still all like, they're all rolled on American made blanks, you know, top line components. So like you're buying an American made product.
Yeah.
It's not rolled overseas or anything like
that. Right.
So, but though the Teleos series is direct to consumer from my website, they're not at my retail location. Oh, just okay. So I can only offer that price kind of doing the, you know,
no middleman.
Yeah, yep. No middleman kind of thing. Yeah.
Yep. And is that over here? No.
No. So I didn't bring that one.
Okay.
Yeah. No.
Yep. And then your, what's the other Amadrona?
Anadromous.
Anadromous. Yeah.
So the Anadromous series comes in the 9-footer and the 10-footer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's the one you're telling me.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's the one we built over there.
Yes. That one's the, that one's the 10-7, but I was telling you about the 9-6. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was the difference?
The length.
Yeah, just the length. Because he was saying he fishes from the raft.
Well, he's like, where do you mostly fish? And I was like, well, Upper Kenai on the raft for trout is what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
If I'm going to pass my rods down.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
Just going to one hitter.
And what did you suggest for him?
9-6.
Yeah.
Yeah, because he's fishing from the boat. Mm-hmm. If you know, I tell people, you know, he's fishing from the raft. That shorter rod is a little nicer when you're trying to net fish and stuff like that. And you're in the boat. You're not really having to reach for stuff, but you know, if you like to pull over a lot, 10 footer is a nice just roll cast it out there, especially for slinging beads and stuff like that.
Totally.
But, yeah.
Sweet.
Okay.
Trivia time. All right.
Rip.
All right. So, the first reported fishing rods were used how many years ago?
Oh, so that was like Egypt, wasn't it?
Oh,
I want to say,
device to catch fish.
I'm going to say 1700s. Or you want to like a closer date?
Well, I'll do the math. 1700s, 500 years ago. Right? Like no, 300 years ago.
Fishing rod. Like
well, you said Egypt. Sticks. So cut in the middle.
I think there was like,
What BC are we going
to? Yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to like rack my brain. Like 600 BC or something like that. I thought I read an article.
First rod? I mean, you got to think like, people like, well, been fishing their whole forever. What's the
definition of like this rod here?
Yeah.
Well, it's like rod, a tool net that they're fishing fish for.
Yeah, I don't. I thought I saw
first. I'm going to say 1750.
All right. Where are you going, Brandon?
I mean, honestly, I think it's like something BC, dude.
Oh, you're going BC.
I don't even know where to go with that. What the dating back to the BC single thing was. Okay, 500 BC.
500 BC. And
yeah,
I think I said 600 BC.
Yeah, there you go.
600 BC. Yep. All right, 2000 BC. So 4,000 years ago.
2000
BC. No, I didn't guess that. You did, because when you started throwing Egypt in there, I'm well, shit.
Egypt was one of the cultures.
How many civilizations rose and fell by that time?
Yeah.
So the first rods were made from 6-foot long bamboo hazel shoots and then thin tapered flexible wood with horsehair attached.
Nice.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah.
So
we figured out some tools a long time ago.
Yeah.
Horsehair was like the line? Or was it
the line, right?
Attached the, I don't know.
Yeah, it didn't really.
The line. I don't know what else.
Just trying to think of like what. Yeah. What would you use?
Yeah.
I don't know. Horsehair.
Oh, yeah, shit.
Horsehair.
You know, they make tooth floss yet.
Yeah.
Or some kind of sinew or something, but
yeah.
Horse hair, that sounds about right.
Horse hair, use like it on like grass, like
cello bows and stuff like that. So yeah. It's pretty durable.
Could I get like there a special horse hair?
I'll make you one. I got to find a horse first. Anybody got a horse, let me know.
That's that first gen monofilament.
There you go.
You just get lessons and bring a little pair of scissors out there.
That's a good question, man. I never even thought of anything like that.
That's cool.
I love that. That was way back.
All right, round two. So what is the state record for rainbow / steelhead?
Ooh.
In weight?
Yeah, in length? Weight. In weight.
Weight.
State record. Oh, man, that's hard.
I'm going to throw out 38.7 pounds.
Ooh.
Is it I might
monster
asking too many questions. State record, hook and line?
Yeah, fish and pole.
Oh,
yeah.
Hook and line, okay. Yep.
38.7.
That's pretty good.
25.
I'm gonna say 34.
42 pounds, 3 ounces.
I wanted to crush 40, but I thought I'd be
so. It's like, for sure a steelhead. It had to be a steelhead.
Yeah. I was thinking too modern. Like that was probably way back in the day, huh?
It was 1970.
70,
yep. And it was caught in Belle Island, which is down near Ketchikan.
Okay.
A 40-pounder. Guy probably thought he had a Chinook on.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, dude. 42-pound steelhead. That'd be amazing.
Would you have caught that in the spring?
Man, it would be like 50 inches long.
Steelhead. You think you put it back?
It said rainbow or steelhead?
Steely.
It says rainbow / steelhead / record.
Doesn't that be a steely, though?
Come on. Don't be doing this.
It's for sure a steelhead.
Yeah, like don't say rainbow / steelhead.
Most likely it would be a steelhead.
And where did you say
it is a steelhead?
Down there in the southeast.
Yeah, it's Belle Island, which has steelhead. So
It's definitely steelhead. Well, 40-something pounds. Come
on. For sure it was.
I mean, that's that whole, like, northwest British Columbia, I mean, the whole stretch has
even like the Olympic monstrosities they used to have. Like, fish used to be so big in the 70s, man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, kings, steelhead.
Yeah.
Like, that's just sad to see. I mean, it used to be so big.
Yeah. One of the guys I worked with on the slope, he showed me a picture of him and his dad on the Russian River as kids, and when he was a kid. And they're coming, you know, they didn't have stringers. They had them on the reds and stuff.
On
the
a
trout
stick.
On a stick, a big log. And all the trout were bigger than the reds on the stick.
Goodness. Oh, they would have the trout on the stick.
Yeah, trout were bigger. I was like, oh, my God.
Just harvesting rainbows.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, you know, now he's a catching from a release upper Kenai guy, you know. Yeah. But,
He used to have a bounty on him.
Oh, really?
I thought they did. Because I think the back in the day, didn't they view them as killing salmon because they were vacuuming up the eggs?
Oh.
I thought there was a bounty on them.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I thought so. You have to fact check me.
That would have been a cool job.
On that.
Oh, yeah. That's just the mindset. I've talked about that before. You know, today it's the mentality is a lot more catch and release on lots of stuff.
Yeah.
I rarely am I harvesting a fish if it isn't salmon or just deep sea fishing. Like nothing else is. Never am I ice fishing to harvest a pan fry fish or anything. But back then, when you went fishing, you brought fish home in a bucket on a stringer.
Yeah.
In the cooler.
Mm-hmm.
Like you brought fish home. You didn't like put fish back.
Yeah.
Even if they taste like mud, you brought the fucking thing home,
that's
right?
That's my mom. Too. She's like, what?
That's what I mean. So
you're throwing that back. No, back.
Yeah, it's like people look at you so sideways and you let a fish go. It's like, I didn't feel like cleaning it. Like, it's mushy meat and I don't want a dolly from Finger Lake, Mom. It's going back in the water, right?
Yeah. I would hate it.
Yeah.
I tell you, I got a dolly redfish in one time in the Kenai. And, man, I 15, 20 minutes, I tried to revive that thing. No. And I'm like, well, shit. It's not going back in. I put it on the string with the reds and brought it home, man. And I'm like, Mom, like, do your best. Like, do something with this thing. Yeah. She did her best job baking that thing. Nasty, dude.
Really?
Oh, the thing was just like... I've eaten pink salmon. That was better.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Trout's never.
I just was like, you know what, man?
I always liked it as a kid.
I eat trout. I eat dolly.
Yeah, it was probably like a 24 incher. Yeah. It was a nice dolly, dude.
Pan fried, dude.
I think it was like maybe an old female or something where it just wasn't. Okay. I mean, dollies are mushy anyway, whatever, however you shake it. But
yeah. It's more sure like a fresh. Like, yeah. You don't want to leave it in the stringer all day.
No, yes. You eat it then.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I ate it. It never froze. I mean, it went from that. It was an overnighter suicide run. And then the next
day. It's one of those, like, catch it, cook it right there.
Yeah.
You're almost on the, hungry as hell, where you're just like, oh, crackers and some, what do you call the fucking cocktail sauce?
But pan fried
tartar sauce. Butter. Sauce. Yeah. Tartar sauce.
Lemon and some salt.
Yeah, dill. I mean, you would think, right? Yeah, fresh fish. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. We ate, before moving to Alaska, I mean, I was, six, seven, eight. We eat trout all the time. It was good.
Yeah. I've eaten them out of lakes and stuff, but it's never like, I've never eaten a trout. I'm like, oh, I got to do this again.
Well, we're spoiled with the other fish we eat here.
That's true. So. Halibut, rockfish, lingcod. Like,
you can't really. Lakers smoke up really good, though.
I was wondering about that.
I've heard people say that.
Yeah, because they're incredibly oily.
Or pickled. Okay. Don't they do jarred?
Really?
Sure. Yeah.
My buddy Bruce, man, we used to, we usually harvest three or four of the smaller Lakers on our spring fishing trip.
Yeah,
and put the bigger ones back and the old fish, and we would just strip them up and he'd smoke them, and then we would transition into kingfish and up at the Deshka, so we'd have a little gallon Ziploc bag of smoked Lakers from that spring's fishing trip, and they were always tasty.
Huh.
Real like oily, melt in your mouth.
Yeah.
Good flavor, but I kind of found it one of the only ways to.
Interesting.
Really. All right, Jackie, hit us.
You guys want to do this last one? Okay.
I do.
So, Matt Manfredi was telling me about the greatest April Fool's joke ever done in Alaska, and it happened down in Sitka, and so by a guy named Porky. And so do you guys know what this joke is?
No,
I don't think so.
Never.
Yeah. You want to guess?
What the joke is with Porky?
This is probably a bad trivia then. But it's so funny. I wanted to bring it up.
Well, I'll just now, bro.
So we're just, the last one will just be storytelling. So in 1970, this guy named Porky, he had 74. He spent the whole year collecting tires. And on the night before, him and his buddies hiked up to the top of Mount Edgecombe, which is the volcano there, the dormant volcano. And they lit them all on fire. And so the whole town thought that Mount Edgecombe was erupting. He was smart enough to let the FAA know and the fire department and a few other people, but he didn't tell the Coast Guard. So the Coast Guard immediately launched their chopper and went up there to go check it out. And there's a big 50-foot letter said, April Fools.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Everyone in the town was cool about it. It's just like, what an awesome culture back then, to be able to like call the chief of police and all these guys, hey, I'm going to do this. And they're like, yeah, get it.
Yeah. Yeah. What year was this?
1974.
Wow, that's crazy. Yeah. Can you imagine called now? I'm like, I'm burned a bunch of tires.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Outrage. Yeah. Yeah. Outrage. Yeah,
you'd be canceled immediately.
Oh, totally. But what a rad April Fool's joke. You think the volcano behind your house is going to go off,
Yeah.
Oh, Edge comes alive.
I mean, you'd think a guy named Porky would pull that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Like, you got a name. If you're named Porky, you got to be doing something.
I guess everyone knew him. He was infamous. Yeah. He's the prankster.
Old Porky.
Yeah.
That's funny.
That's definitely a did you know?
Yeah.
No, right, we're really like, did you know? We're going to crack that off. Any new sponsors want to come in?
Brought to you by Alaska Rod Co. Did you know?
Did you know? Porky burned a bunch of tires and fucked with everybody in April once. That
up. Is Porky still alive?
I don't think so.
You got to have Porky on. Yeah. Find Porky and get him on.
That's 74, man. He'd probably be an old boy years ago. By now.
He's got a kid.
Sporky.
Porky Jr.
Or Pork Chop.
He tried it, but he was just burning the little sporks.
Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah, you would never get away. I mean.
Oh, no.
I just think about, the world's changed, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Fuck, dude.
Yeah, a lot.
Who hauled all those tires up there, though, for real?
That's
him and his buddies. Yep. They hiked them all up.
We just throw them on each shoulder.
Throw them in the.
Wonder if they spent a week doing it. I'm not sure.
Say, that's a lot of effort.
Yeah.
Now I'm wondering how that really even happened.
Yeah. I got to look this up.
People were tougher back then, Brandon. He did it.
That's the truth. Definitely. And he wasn't wearing crispy boots. I can guarantee you that.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Bunny boots.
Extra tough. Yeah.
Okay, well, walk us through the process of making a rod?
Yeah. So all rods start just the blank. So blank means just the carbon fiber rod. And so when you initially get a blank, there's a couple things you want to check. You want to check the ferrules of it. So make sure there's no micro cracks, make sure everything's, you know, nice and flush in the furrows. And then what you'll do is you'll assemble the rod and you'll put it in what's called a spine finder. And so with multiple sections, like a four-piece rod, you'll put each section into the spine finder. And then you'll put a little flex on it, and then the blank will fall into its natural curvature.
Mm.
And then you'll take a Chinese marker and you'll go underneath and you'll mark the spine.
What's a Chinese marker?
It's like a little white marker that you can mark stuff with and easily rub it off.
Okay.
Like, so you can mark things and then it won't permanently be there. But so you want to find the spine.
Yeah.
That's the natural curvature. And so with fly rods, when you find the spine, you want to put the guide on the spine.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with spinning rods, right? Because the guides are going to be underneath sitting on the spine.
Okay.
And so when you're casting that rod and it's on the spine, you're going with the natural curvature, and so when you cast it, the rod's not going to want to wobble back and mm-hmm. forth. It's going to want to go on the same trajectory of how it naturally bends.
Right.
Right. And so that's where you're. And then if you do like a casting style rod where you mark the spine, you're going to flip the rod over and build on top of the spine.
Mm.
So the natural curvature is going to be up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So you're still going to, it's still not going to walk back and forth for the casting. Setting the hook, you have that lifting power.
Right, right.
Mm. So the spine's important, and so that's the first step, find the spine.
Yeah.
And then you go into the guides. So the guides are really cool because they can be made out of so many different things. So
for people that don't know, what is the guides?
So the guides is what the line runs through, basically. That's what you
thread the little loops.
Line. Yeah, little loops on the rod.
Okay.
And guides can be anything, and I like to take a minute and talk about guides. It's a teeny bit.
No, go ahead.
Yeah. So for guides, people say this is titanium guides. I'm like, ooh, that's really good. But what people need to realize is this is the guide frame and this is the ceramic insert. They're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
And so usually, like this is a full titanium guide. Usually when the guide is like full titanium, it has a high-end ceramic insert
mm-hmm.
inside of it. And so that's a big thing when you're looking at a rod is when you're reading the sheet and say, what type of guides does it have?
Mm-hmm.
It'll say either, you know, a stainless steel with aluminum oxide rings in it. So stainless steel is good for like fresh water. And, you know, if it's powder coated, double plated chrome, it'll hold up well in fresh water. And you can take it in the salt. And as long as you rinse it, it'll have a long life.
Mm-hmm.
But it has the potential to corrode and rust.
Mm.
Okay. That's where titanium comes in.
Got it.
And so, but with the titanium guides, like see this one here, titanium frame, and the insert ring is a nanolite ring insert. And that means nothing to nobody except for the ring inserts. They're a mix of like ceramic blend, and mm-hmm. there's a thing called the Vickers hardness test,
mm-hmm.
and that's how they measure hardness
in
like diamonds and stuff.
Sure.
And so like aluminum, well there's stainless steel rings which have a Vickers of like 400
uh-huh.
hardness, all the way up to nanolite is like an 1800 on the hardness scale.
Oh shit.
And then the highest on the list is silicon carbide. So if you see SIC
mm-hmm.
listed on a website, that they're talking about the guide ring,
mm-hmm.
and that's sitting about 2200 to 2400 on the hardness scale. And so that's kind of the rundown on a guide.
And so what's the advantage of going harder?
So there's a couple advantages. So harder obviously means when it's harder, it'll distribute the heat better,
mm-hmm.
and it'll have less friction.
Okay.
So your line will shoot farther.
Mm.
But on the flip side of that, harder means more brittle.
Mm-hmm.
And the new ceramic guides are pretty darn good.
Uh-huh.
But a silicon carbide insert ring will have a much higher like impact damage. So if mm-hmm. you step on it or something, it has the potential to chip. Whether if you have a stainless steel has the pliability of it,
to
bend it and then bend it back.
Yeah.
So stainless steel, it might groove more, but it's also going to be more pliable to like durability as far as impact resistant. Right. Yeah, so that's kind of the lowdown on the guides. Okay. Did you have any questions about the guides? Because I kind of like to overview the guides a little bit.
What do you on the one that we built in the back? What's the name of that rod again?
Andronymous.
Anadromous.
Anadromous. Yeah. What kind of guides are on that one?
So those are SS. So there's different kinds of stainless steel. Uh-huh. So there's stainless steel 304 and then 316. Mm-hmm. 316 being marine grade stainless steel. So that has 316 stainless steel. And then the guides are double black plated chrome snake guides.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they're a metal guide instead of ceramic?
Yeah. So the guides, the guide frames are metal, stainless steel. Yeah. And then the inserts on them are aluminum oxide.
Okay.
Which aluminum oxide on the Vickers scale is sitting around 1,200 to 1,400.
Okay.
It's a great all around. And on fly rods, aluminum oxide rings, they're good because... You know, for a lot of time where you can run into, like, if you run a braid, braid can sometimes groove rings if it gets a lot of gunk on it. Yeah. Stuff like glacial silt.
Mm-hmm.
Glacial silt will get on the line and run through it back and forth.
Get erosion.
And over years, it could groove the ring.
Right.
But, again, rod building's funny because everybody's got their own opinion. There's tons of forums saying, like, oh, I've had this... aluminum oxide rings on my halibut rod forever and never had a problem. And other guys are saying, like, well, mine grew in 2 years.
Yeah.
And it kind of goes back to what kind of line you're running and what that line is in. Because, like I said, you're running that line in glacial silt.
Yeah.
Or some dirty, mucked up water. And then it gets all coated on that line. It's running through back and forth. You do that for the rod's whole life.
Yeah.
Or you're fishing a crystal clear lake.
Yeah.
Never have that. So that's kind of a thing. Like if you're having somebody build you a custom rod or you're looking at a rod, definitely like reach out to me and ask, or ask the builder, or their responsibility, I think, is to ask you, like, what do you want to use the rod for? What kind of water are you going to be fishing in? So they can hand tailor the guide to what you want to do. Cause guides are a huge part of the rod.
Right.
Yeah. But yeah, sorry.
That was great explanation. That was awesome. That was great.
Yeah, no, I feel like it needs to be said because, a lot of people are just like, this is a titanium guide. And it's like, well, yes.
Yeah,
but
why?
It has the different ring inserts. And going at, like, there is a guide from Fuji called Torzite.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not as hard as SIC, but they say that the friction on it and everything else is way more smooth, and it's like 40% less material than SIC.
Mm.
But one of those guides, like a standard guide like this big, would be $35.
Oh, wow.
It's crazy expensive. But they swear on the Torzite being like the best thing ever.
Yeah.
But yeah, so different rings, even though they are harder, they have different properties and different, you know, heat distribution, different slickness to them and stuff like that. And so yeah, if anybody's out there wanting to build a rod, the rings go on aluminum oxide, alkalite, Nanolite, SIC, Torzite. And so that's kind of the progressing scale of hardness and quality and stuff like that. Okay. So, but they all have different properties, but, you know.
Yeah. Each going place. Full geek here?
Yeah, we went full scientific. Yeah.
What's the hardest, most challenging, like, mother effort rod to build?
The hardest one? Or
the one where a dude orders it and you're like, God damn it.
I got to build two of these.
And an extra tip.
Yeah, I think I don't even have my lineup, but halibut.
Halibut?
Yeah. And but the thing that...
You're answering two questions at once.
Oh.
Yeah. See, halibut...
There's a follow-up
noise the heck out of me just because they're so big and bulky.
Yeah.
And I like things like really like streamlined, like minimalist epoxy. So the weight, and I'm a finesse fisherman.
Uh-huh.
So I like everything balanced perfectly, everything straight.
Yeah.
But
can we have a conversation off the mic?
Yeah. I mean, I still like making halibut rods, but it's just like the guides are so big and rolling it and everything. It seems like a much less smoother, methodical process than it's like building.
It's like a baseball bat.
Exactly.
Just build a whopper stopper.
You're building a meat stick. Like this thing. Yeah, it's going in. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, just a beast. But yeah, so going back to the process. So you got the guides. We went on a long rabbit trail about guides. And then each guide, see, these are called double guide foots. So that means they have two little foots on them.
Oh.
And you have to, Some people don't, but you have to take a, I have a little Dremel, and I grind down each end of the guide foot. So, because there's usually the guide foot's kind of bulky at the end. So it
lays down
on there. So it's a good, smooth transition. Mm. So when you're wrapping the rod, if it's a big bump you're trying to jump the wrapping thread up on, it can be just a pain.
Yeah, you got this nice bevel
there. Yeah, so aesthetically, it's really nice. And then, yeah, and then the epoxy, when you put that on, it's going to be a nice sloping ramp to it. And it's not going to be bulbous. And then the thread's going to sit on a light a lot nicer. But so that's the guides. I wrap the guides on, or I grind the guides. And then from there, I'll do the handle. And handle could be multiple different things or material. So on the Anadromous series fly rod, my handles are black. And so partly I do that just because I like the look of it. Because, you know, like you're floating down the river, you walk to the fly shop. You see them black handles, you know. Mm. It's Alaska Rodco. But on the flip side of it, it's not all for show, but I just like it too.
Yeah.
But so this is
stealth.
Yeah, burnt burled cork. Mm. So it's black, and it's essentially the name, like your traditional yellow cork. They're going to take that, and they're going to basically, like, for lack of a better term, grind it into a powder, recondense it. Or grind it into a powder, burn it, recondense it, and then put it into the handle. And so, if you're looking at that handle right now, the center of that handle, the black part, is burnt burl cork. And since it's been recondensed, it's a lot more, obviously, dense. So, when things are more dense,
packed tight,
more sensitive. Oh. And then the top half, where your feelers are, your pointer finger and your thumb, that's where you're always holding it to feel, right? So, where you're holding it with those two fingers, I brought down, that's rubberized cork. So, it's a composite of, like, rubber and cork. So that stuff's never going to chip.
So it's like blended?
Yeah, it's like a blended composite. From here to here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, or if you can pull that off, too, if you want to feel the rubber.
Oh, I see the line now.
Yeah,
okay.
Does anyone have a knife or something like that? Yeah.
Yeah.
Here. But it's kind of cool to feel. But, yeah, I did this for several reasons. So you can feel. And also, when your thumb is rubbing, you're casting it for your entire life.
No, you don't rub it raw.
You're not going to rub it raw. And then the handle's not going to decay. And all that kind of stuff.
Mm. Gotcha. Yeah, that's what I always get is like the chunks of the cork come out after a while.
Where it rubs on your finger right there?
Yeah, it's usually where my thumb is. And my fingernail, like the way that I fish, sometimes like...
Oh, grabs it?
My thumbnail.
Oh, it digs in.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like a habit.
Yeah.
It's like different hand positions.
Yeah, you know? Feel that. And it's more...
Oh, I see.
It's
more, so you can see now the different colors.
So the composite rubberized is going to be on either end because usually the edges of traditional cork will chip or people stick their fly in it or something like that. Sure. So it wants to chip, right?
Yeah.
And if you look, even the fighting butt...
bumped a lot.
Yeah, even the fighting butt has a ring of composite cork on either side, so that can't chip either. And so I wanted to make it durable because, I mean, these things obviously live in Alaska.
Yep.
I wanted it durable. I wanted it to stand out and more. And I really wanted, going back to the finesse fishing thing, I wanted it more sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
Every fly rod I held, I'm like, I want to feel more. Yep. And then when I got these, I was like, this is it.
Yeah.
Like it's all the boxes for me. It's durable. It's sensitive. And it just has a longevity factor. Wow. And it's extremely grippy.
Way more grip on this stretch.
Yep.
I mean, it just grabs.
Yep.
And it looks so clean and nice.
Yeah, it does. Yep. So when you grind those cork up into powder and then you mix in with a resin or?
So I don't do the grinding part. Uh-huh. They come to me in little rings and like that. Yeah. But anyway, so I'll fit the handle. So I'll fit the handle. And so like this is a 4-piece fly rod blank. So I'll take the bottom section of that 4-piece blank. And I'll fit the handle, and then I'll put the reel seat on there. It's a two-part, like, bonding epoxy glue, so it's crazy hard stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll use tape arbors for the reel seat, because obviously the reel seat's bigger than the blank. So you'll tape arbors onto the blank, fit everything, and then I have, like, clamps, like wooden clamps. And I'll fit the handle, put it in the clamp, and then clamp it tight for 4 hours.
Oh, so hold.
It holds it all in place.
Cure it all
perfectly.
Up.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And so, and while the handle's curing, I'm over there, I'm wrapping.
Yeah.
And so, so that's going along with the process. While the handle's curing, for wrapping the rod, there's different types of thread. And so there's nylon, there's polyester, and then there's silk. So if you ever see those rods that look like they have no thread,
yeah,
it just looks like the guides on there. Yeah. That's silk.
Oh, super thin.
Yeah, super thin. And when you put epoxy on it, almost like
it looks clear, almost.
Right. Yeah, kind of. Yeah, and then there's the nylon, which is a really standard one, and then there's polyester, ultra poly, and that's what I use. It's made by Fuji, and it's, to me, it's more cleaner. It's thinner in diameter. It lays down a lot nicer, and it's incredibly strong. And so that's the one that I use.
Looks sharp.
Yeah, thank you.
It's got a nice finish.
Yeah, and there's different types of thread diameter, too. And there's also a thread called non-color preserver and color preserver. And so going into the size of the thread, like a standard fly rod is going to have what's called size A thread. So it's thinner. A is an alpha. So it's a thinner thinner thread. And then if you're going for like a big deep sea halibut rod, you want size D. You want to give them the D.
I like giving them the D. Yeah, the big D. Let me tell you something about D.
Yeah.
Wrap that shit with some D.
Yeah. Put some D on there.
Give them the D.
Yeah, yeah. But no, so that's so D size thread. So it's like, obviously
okay,
bigger.
Boys, we got
obviously
we got
bigger.
Bigger in diameter. And yeah, so it's obviously more strong. So that would be the difference in thread. But now I lost my train
of thought. So it's the strength of the thread. Huh?
Yeah, the strength of the thread.
You guys said it first.
Yeah, right. I brought it up. I brought it myself. But yeah, and then color preserver. So if you look at the Van Halen rod, so if it needs to be something called color preserved. And so, because if you just put standard like sewing thread on there and you throw epoxy on the top, that's probably not going to come out red like it is. Once you put epoxy on it, it's going to dilute the color. And it's not
like a solvent
almost. Yeah, almost. Yeah. And so some people, they'll use what's called a color preserver where you actually like take the color preserver and like paint it on the thread so it seals the color in there. Yeah. Or you can purchase
almost like
color,
a base coat.
Yeah, almost. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or you can purchase a thread that already has color preserver treated in it. And that's what I use.
It won't discolor once you apply the epoxy.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. And then
it's a really cool rod. Man.
On this one, did you put the epoxy and then a little thread around it there?
No. So for there, I was trying to figure out how to do the Van Halen paint job with thread. And so that's actually a base of thread. And then I took long strands of the white and black thread and underlocked it under the red. And then as the rod was turning, I sporadically wrapped all over the place.
Oh, crisscross.
Yeah. Yep. And then I had two pull-through loops for when the white and black were done. I pulled it up underneath the red and then sealed it. Yeah. Which was kind of tricky to do.
Yeah, that's a detail.
Yeah. Did you have like a one shot at that? I mean,
I just sat down and I was like, how do I do this? And then, yeah. No, I was kind of like, yeah, one shot. Or otherwise, you'd have to rewrap it.
Well, that's what I mean. Like it's cool too because every wrap is a little different.
Yes.
Which shows dude, you can tell it's. like a machine or robot didn't make it, dude.
It's sporadic. It's got that human hand. On it. Yeah,
yeah, dude.
Yeah. So that's the thread. And then I'll thread the rod. And then from there, another good trick, too, when you're threading guides on, a lot of people, they'll thread all the guides on, and then they'll kind of straighten out all the guides. And that once they're done threading it. But a good trick to do is when you're threading the guides as you go, thread one guide on, then thread the next one, and then line those up, and then keep going down.
Is there a specific spacing?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. So that's a whole other thing. We'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah. But so for the guides, you definitely want to make sure they're straight as you go, because if you're done with the whole rod and they're all over the place, you want to straighten them. The more you move your guides, the more the little thread can move, and it'll be packed less. And then, because this looks like solid black, but that's just because it's packed tight. But if you move the guides too much when you're trying to straighten them, you'll get little gaps, and it's still fine, but it's unsightly.
Yeah.
You know. So that's a trick for the wrapping, and then you go to epoxy. Epoxy was the hardest thing to get down to look kind of like $1 million.
Yeah.
It took a lot of epoxy, and there's multiple different types of epoxies on the market. But the one I found, when I finally found it, I was like, this is the stuff. And so this epoxy. I'll put it on, and with the thread, when you wrap it on the rod and you put epoxy on, sometimes there can be air bubbles trapped underneath the thread. So some people, they make the mistake. They're like, all right, I got this rod done. I'm going to coat it. They coat it with a bunch of thick epoxy, and they come back, little bubbles escape. Mm-hmm. And then so you're like, oh, this thing looks like junk. And yep. So what I use a three-step process for epoxy. What I'll do is I'll take and I'll just lightly coat the threads. Mm-hmm. So if any bubbles come up, it's not going to, you know, appear because yeah. it's so thin they can't make bubbles. Mm. So I'll coat it.
Like fills the gaps almost.
Yeah, it seals it. Seals mm-hmm. all the threads off for no bubbles. And then I'll let it sit and roll. They have to rotate, otherwise the epoxy will sag.
Yep.
So it rotates for a minimum of 4 hours at 77 degrees. I like it hanging between 77 and 80.
Mm-hmm. So it just gets a balanced cure.
Yep, yeah, it's balanced cure. And more or less it keeps everything proportionate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and so I'll do one coat of that, 4 hours, and then a second coat. And then with the second coat, if you look closely, all the little nooks and crannies of the edge of the guide are sealed. And if you see me, I always got a toothpick in my mouth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's because you want to get a toothpick in there, and you want to, because there's always going to be a teeny little gap in between the guide foot and the thread.
Yeah.
And again, not a huge deal, but if you don't, yeah, you want to get some epoxy up underneath mm-hmm. there, because 20 years down the road, if water's a little
gets in
little
there,
thing in there, yeah. water will get in there, start to rot it, and then, because I want the rod to outlive you, kind of thing. Yeah, so right. you got to kind of prep yeah. it. So.
You want it to be passed down generations.
I noticed the epoxy seal underneath, too. I saw that.
Yep. Yeah. So for you, and that was the trickiest part with epoxy is making sure you're getting the right amount mm-hmm. for each one, because you want it exactly proportionate. I mean, you can't, like, measure out each guide foot to how much epoxy. You just kind of got to eyeball it. Yeah, you got to eyeball it. So that's the biggest thing, is you got to learn how much to do and how much you're going to apply it so it looks, like, you know, nice and streamlined. They call it the football effect. If you put too much epoxy on, it's going to look bulbous like a football, right?
Oh, got it.
Yeah, and so that's kind of a learning curve to that. And another thing, too, like, see the edges of the epoxy? They're nice and straight. That comes from speed. So with I have a rod lathe, and some people they'll take the epoxy, they'll kind of apply it, and then they'll flip it over, and when the epoxy sags, they'll kind of sweep away the excess. But my method is you get that rod ripping really fast on the rod lathe, so it's spinning like crazy, and then I'll take a metal spatula, and then I'll hit it, and I'll kind of guide the epoxy around, because epoxy wants to go where epoxy has already been. So as long as you can create that straight line, and then you can move the rest of the epoxy over, boom, it'll stay in that straight line.
So you can shift it as it cures?
Yep, you kind of shift it, move it around where you want to go. So that's a kind of a art form in itself, is making sure you're putting the epoxy nice mm-hmm. and straight where you want it to go. And a lot of people, where they have trouble is, like in the ferrule section, I think I don't have the section here from the sockeye rod, but so you got your.
What does that mean?
So it's the connecting piece. Okay. So it's the next section. Mm-hmm. And so you're going to
see the female
yeah,
part.
Yeah, the female mm-hmm. part. And then people want to wrap, but sometimes to get to the edge of that section, that's a hard spot to wrap. But also, if you put too much epoxy on it, the epoxy is going to sag. There's all that weight. You have too much epoxy on it, it's going to pull it away from the edge. Yeah, so right there.
Thanks.
Thank you. So if you look at the end here, so some people have trouble. They put way too much excess epoxy, and then the end of that rod, it's going to start sagging. It's going to take the epoxy away from the ferrule section. Mm-hmm. And so you're gonna get done coating your rod, think you did a great job, and then you're going to get back, and you can see the epoxy like kind of oozed away from the edges. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's another thing you want to make sure is the right amount of epoxy is going to save your life.
Right.
I love the black.
Yeah, black on black.
Oh, looks beautiful. Yeah, yeah. Looks good.
Yep. Yeah, so that's the epoxy. So three coats, minimum of 4 hours. And then, the rod has to roll at 77 plus degrees for a minimum of 4 hours before it's, you know, sag free. It's solid. You can turn it off. It's still tacky, but it's not going to sag.
Yep. Firmed up enough.
Yep. And then from there, it has to cure for 24 hours for all the chemicals inside the epoxy to cross-link. Mm. And so, and then finally firm up, and then you can go fish it.
Oh, you can go that soon.
Yep. So that's the minimum. I mean, I But yeah, so that's the minimum, but I like it a little cured a little bit more, but you can definitely go. I've done it before, you know.
Well, that brings me to a rather big question as far as you explain the process. So manufacturing.
Yeah.
You're building stuff out of your home shop.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about those hour chunks that it takes to wrap, and then you've got the epoxy curing, and you've got, I mean, how... You got it down to kind of like an assembly line?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, and everybody always asks me, like, how long does it take you to build a rod?
Yeah.
And each one is different. But for, say, a 9-foot fly rod with, so nine, in the rule kind of gets foggy, but generally a 9-foot fly rod is going to have 10 guides. It's usually a guide for every foot plus one. Mm. And so a 10-foot or a 9-foot fly rod takes me about under 2 hours to wrap.
Mm-hmm.
And then each epoxy coat, epoxy has to be applied within 30 minutes. That's its working time. Otherwise, it gets too tacky and gummy and doesn't come on nice.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Got a window.
So, yep. So within, so it's usually under 2 hours, and then typically anywhere from 10 to 15 minutes, depending on the intricacy to do each coat. So that's the typical, that's the general time frame to do that. And then, of course, the decal section too. The decal section actually took a long time to hammer out because it's a long, that's all epoxy. So, like, the big, like, decal over Alaska Rodco, getting that.
Placing it.
Yeah, getting it straight.
Sure.
That bugs the heck out of me, is making sure the decal is straight. And then also, that's a long chunk of epoxy to make sure that there's no dips. No, like, you can hold it up to the light even and it's clean. Nice and crystal flat.
Yeah. So would you say, like, on average, it's a rod a day?
Yeah, so... My production, what I try and do is I'll wrap three rods, slap some epoxy on them, put it in the box, and then while those are rotating their 4 hours, then I just go to town and start wrapping others while those are on the rack. And then it's just a forever conveyor belt that just kind of never ends.
Yeah, I was just kind of like trying to average out when you do the basic stuff, then you do your guides, then you do your wrap, and then... Like, even down to wrapping the plastic around it.
Yeah.
I mean, like, when it's, like, a fully shipped out the door, it comes out to three rods a day then, I guess?
Yeah, I would say
three rods a day?
Roughly. Okay. Yeah, depending, you know.
That seems like pretty good production.
It is, but, I mean, also, you take into factor, you know, people shoot me emails, calling me, like, oh, I bought this rod. What reel should I have on? What line should I use? You know, or like, I'm thinking about the, you know, tons of questions coming in, which I love talking rods anyway. But
sure.
So it's never just a smooth production line. Yeah. There's tons of hats and stuff.
A few
like
hours
that.
Of your day and
chunks
of your time that you
so it's
peel away for that.
Yeah, so it's
community
usually,
side.
Yeah, unless it's like, I try and answer emails whenever, like I'll shoot off emails at like 11 o'clock at night or something, but it's not uncommon. I think one of the recent days I clocked 17 hours of wrap time, which is going at it.
Filling an order or something like that?
Yep.
What's the email?
Yeah. AlaskaRodco@gmail.com. Okay. Yep. Yeah, so if anybody's got a question about the rods or anything, just shoot me an email, and I love talking rods.
Yep.
Yeah, but so that's kind of the production. It's, you know, it's a lot, but luckily it's such an addiction. You know, it's when I, you know, going back to working a 9-to-5, you would go back and your boss would do your performance review.
Yeah.
And they would say like, oh, you know, you did great, you know, and all this stuff. And like, you know, I'll be here back from your patient. You're great and all this stuff. I'm like, that's nice. But it was the first time. It was one of my first rods. Someone bought it and they came back and said, this is the best rod I've ever used in my life.
Wow.
And it just hit me.
Yeah.
I had never had a feeling like that. There was never a feeling in the world. And I was like, this is, you know, you felt like you were put on the earth to build rods.
Yeah.
You know, it's
a feeling. That's a great feeling, I bet.
Struck your heart, didn't it?
Yeah, it did.
Right away.
Yeah.
Well, you can tell you're passionate about what you do.
Thank you.
That's a love, right?
Oh, it's a love.
Pays the bills.
It's an addiction.
Supports a life, but it's more than that, right?
It's way more than that, yeah. Mm. And I credit to, you know, I'm just nothing more than a glorified dope building rods in my garage. Like the whole business side. Luckily, my wife, she's a bookkeeper and also works for a tax prep.
Oh.
And so she's got it down, the business accounts.
Takes a team, man.
Yep. She's got all that side of it because I'm not that smart to finagle the whole.
I'll be in the shop. I mean.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I got epoxy to lay down over here. You got to pay the taxes, would you?
Yep, exactly. So, yeah, it's definitely a team effort, and I'd love to grow it into a point where, you know, I'm looking for land right now to build a dedicated shop.
Yeah.
So if anybody's got land on the Kenai Peninsula, Greater Soldotna area, hit me up. But it's hard to find land right now. But so yes, looking for a shop, and then eventually I would like to take it to full scale manufacturing in Soldotna. You know, have a couple employees start hiring some help. And
do you have anybody that's been reaching out, or maybe that you've brought in the shop to just kind of rub elbows and help out?
Yeah, there's been a couple people you know, stopping by and just kind of showing them the ropes and stuff like that. Nice. It's a tough thing, you know. If I did bring somebody on, it would be, you know, trying to find that person who's, you know, detailed and could roll it. Yeah.
It's not quite like I did, but it's close.
Exactly. Yeah, it's got to be like an apprenticeship thing, you know. But we all got to start somewhere, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you did go full like manufacturer, would you manufacture the blanks too?
Ooh, I want to do that.
Yeah.
Oh, that drives me insane.
Oh, really? I want to do that from scratch.
Oh, I want to do that so bad. Oh. But the whole machinery to do that is like starting at a quarter mil. Right. Like, it's a lot. Yeah. You got to have like big, huge industrial ovens and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You got to grind all the mandrels. Like, I priced it out. Uh-huh. And then you got to have the know-how.
And isn't there a lot of computer systems and things too in place on that?
Yeah, there's a ton of even just the mandrel. You got to put that thing in like a CAD program. And mandrels, when I say a mandrel, that's a steel, like pipe basically that's grinded down to the shape of a fishing rod. Mm-hmm. And it's not just like it's just grinded down like a slow taper. Then it would just cast like a broomstick.
Right.
So these mandrels are like put in a CAD. Like grinded down funky tapers and stuff like that. And so it's a huge undertaking, and you got to have a composite engineering kind of background and as well as like a machining.
Oh yeah.
So, which I got folks who do that kind of thing, but it's just a matter of, you know,
putting it all together,
getting all. So that's the dream. And so I swear I'm going to do it.
Oh, you'll get there.
But keep going, man.
Yeah. But yeah, so that's the big one. Is I just want the full production here.
Yeah.
So.
What's the differences between like four pieces versus the two pieces? Is there's one that's maybe has more strength, or is it mostly just for like
travel? Well, a lot of it's travel. Like a four piece is pretty universal, especially here in the fly industry, because you fly outs, bust it down, you know, you can put it anywhere and stuff like that. And so, and three pieces too, but like in, like the Van Halen is a two piece, and I've made that specifically so I wouldn't travel with it. It's such a wonderful. Oh, and then here I am flying with it.
Travel with you today.
Yeah, so that's a big part of it. It's just the travel aspect. And
anytime you have multiple points of a connecting piece, doesn't that weaken it?
Some people say that the general progression of the taper, it's not as smooth. And so some people argue like, oh, like I want a one piecer, because I mean that'll be just butter smooth. It's a smooth, there's no tip to transitions. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but honestly, Fairlink systems nowadays are so darn
Fairlink, you called it
Fairlink, like Fairlink. a rod ferrule.
Okay.
Yeah, which is the
female end.
Yeah, thank you. That's so darn good these days. It's pretty hard to beat. And there's multiple ferrule types. There's tip over butt, which is the usual like TFO kind of style, and then there's spigot ferrules or furls. I get them mixed up, but the spigot is let me look at this one.
It's the other way around.
It's basically it's more of, instead of like it completely engulfing the next section, this one kind of inserts up inside of it. So there's going to be like a little space in between. And why they do that is they say it's a little more streamlined of a transition. Mm. So it's a little more smooth. again, things are pretty advanced nowadays. I don't, you know, they both feel pretty darn good. Yeah. So they both have their own properties, but
I feel like you'd have to do an absorbent amount of fly fishing with both types to really be able to feel
exactly
the difference of that.
Everything else being perfect, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
and mean, then a lot of times in Alaska, you're fishing with lead. Like you have split shots on your line, and it
just eliminates any of that feel right away. Like,
I mean,
general, it should, right?
I mean, it's like riding an e-bike, you know?
Yeah,
for casting is what it is. Yeah.
Good analogy there.
Totally.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's so much that goes into a rod, you know. Yeah. I mean, even from the manufacturing side of it. So yeah, it's definitely, you know, I'm always trying to just keep reading about it, keep learning. It's hard being in Alaska because, like, you lived in, like, Woodland, Washington. That's, like, kind of like the mecca of where everything was born, you know. And, like Fenwick originated in, like, the 60s, 70s or whatever from Washington. So, like, that's kind of the hub, you know. And so, and, like, grinding the mandrels and all that kind of stuff, that's, like, super secretive stuff. Yeah, you can't just like call up somebody like, I really want to get into this. They'd be like, this is our secret sauce. I don't know about this.
What's your like event game like? I mean, as far as going down to the States and taking your products to a venue or?
Yeah, I just started doing like, I went, I'm going to do the sports show in Soldotna.
Okay.
And then I was at the Bleeding Heart Brewery Palmer.
For the Moose Call.
Moose Call thing. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah. So I just now started doing shows and stuff like, and just kind of doing public events. I'm doing a lot more with TU, Trout Unlimited, Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. I'm starting to get involved with them. So yeah, just do more marketing. I never really needed to. It was always just word of mouth, and I liked the slow growth of it.
Totally.
I liked
being organic.
Yeah, organic. Yeah. I didn't want to, you know, just do a bunch of like ads and stuff like that. I really wanted it to be more of an authentic thing.
Jeopardize quality.
Exactly. Yeah. I didn't want to grow faster than what I wanted.
Yeah. Don't get into Costco yet.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I'm just now starting to do shows. So cool. You'll see me at the Solana Sports Show, and I might do the Matsu show next year. And
People are going to eat that up that don't know about you yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they're about to find out a lot more on Alaska Wild Project. But
yeah.
To get in the shows and into the public eye, especially, I think just last year, you know, the Great Alaska Sportsman Show in Anchorage was in Denina after years in Sullivan and post-COVID. And it was like everybody wanted it really bad.
Yeah.
To get back out there and see new products. And, you know, people were very successful in those shows where I think maybe beforehand, a lot of folks were starting to pull out of that kind of stuff. Like, it wasn't really worth the investment and time and money to go to a venue and set up. But for a startup like you, getting into the public eye, people being able to put their hands on your rod.
Totally. The wiggle test. Everybody's got to do the wiggle test. That's the big one. You got to get in there.
You don't know. You're like, oh that one feels good.
I don't know what it should feel like.
Yeah. But. Honey, bust out the Alaska Airlines credit card. I got to have this.
Made a sound. It's right. Called my name.
Wiggle test. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny.
It's like a Harry Potter wand.
Now you got to set up the old tank over there in the corner and be like, Try it out.
Yeah.
Yeah. You just have a little whistle in the background.
Yep. Yeah.
Well, that one picked you. You got to buy it.
Well, Matt, thanks for coming in, man. I know that we're kind of on a time crunch here to get you back to the airport. We're going to have to bust out of here soon. Yeah. So if anyone that's looking to get in contact with you, the email is alaskarodco@gmail, alaskarodco.com. Obviously, if you're looking to purchase a rod, we do have Father's Day coming up, Mother's Day coming up as well. And you said they can find them at Wilderness Way, and what were the other two stores you said?
Mountain View Sports.
Anchorage, yeah, okay.
And then I believe
Mossy's
might be out of them. I'm not sure. I'll contact Mike.
Damn, you need to ramp up production to four a day,
right?
At Alaska Rodco on Instagram too, man. Check out his Instagram, follow him. Rad photos. Your products are beautiful.
Thank you.
Matt, thanks for coming in, dude.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, thanks for sharing your story, most of all, man.
Thank you.
Like, you're another beautiful Alaskan success story that's started something amazing, and it feels like you've just hit the tip of the iceberg from what it sounds like.
Yeah, I just keep going.
Good luck,
man,
to you, man.
Yep. Thank you.
Keep following your passion. Going.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you, Alaska. Thanks for listening. Thank you, Matt, for coming in, spending your time with us. Check them out. Definitely support Alaskans as we do up here in Alaska. Appreciate everyone. As I always be,
stay wild.
You remember my speaking to you of what I call your overcautiousness. Are you not overcautious when you assume that you cannot do what the enemy is constantly doing?
The Alaska Wild Project podcast is brought to you by the following sponsors.
Barney's Sports Chalet, supplying hunters with the best hand-selected gear since 1963. The exclusive home of frontier gear built for the rugged Alaskan terrain. Your one-stop shop for all your outdoor needs. Visit Barney's today at 906 West Northern Lights.
Tailored Restoration 24-Hour Emergency Home Services, helping Alaskans restore their dreams since 1972. Services include fire, water, mold, post-emergency cleaning, repair, and remodeling. Give them a call in Anchorage, Eagle River, Matsu, or Fairbanks. Hit them up at tailoredrestorationalaska.com.
Total Truck and Alaska Overlander, Alaska's premier supplier for custom automotive accessories and overlanding products, providing all-inclusive rental vehicles and trailers custom outfitted to explore the Alaskan backcountry with a unique and convenient traveling experience.
TheTreehouseAK.com, located at 341 Boniface Parkway, Alaska's own and grown cannabis and CBD store. Ask the budtender what the strain of the day is to get your 10% off. The Treehouse, where the culture lives. AKO Farms, located in Sitka, Alaska, built from the ground up with concentrates as their single motivation, with exclusive products such as their sugar wax, full spectrum diamond sauce carts, and more. Ask your local budtender about AKO. Marijuana has intoxicating effects and may be habit-forming and addictive. Marijuana impairs concentration, coordination, and judgment. Do not operate a vehicle or machinery under the influence. There are health risks associated with consumption of marijuana for the use of only by adults 21 and older. Keep out of the reach of children, and marijuana should not be used by women who are pregnant or breastfeeding.
The Bait Shack, located on Ship Creek upstream of the bridge. Can't miss the bright red shack. They are the go-to fishing gear rental and guide service on Ship Creek. Tight lines and fish on. Come hook into the action with them. Hit them up at thebaitshackak.com.
Snow Pro AK, your snow and ice management company specializing in business and residential properties. They know what it takes to keep your property presentable and safe. Give them a call for a free estimate at 280-7098 or visit lawnproak.com. Double Shovel Cider Company, located off of Arctic and 58th, handcrafted Alaskan-made colonial ciders. They also have a tap room downtown on the corner of 5th and E. Stop by today and taste an award-winning cider.
The Alaska Chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. BHA is the voice of our Alaskan public lands, waters, and wildlife. Their goal is to uphold our hunting and fishing legacy while keeping our public lands wild. Stand up today and join BHA at backcountryhunters.org.
I say try. If we never try, we shall never succeed. This proposition is a simple truth, and it's too important to be lost sight of for a moment. If we cannot beat the enemy where he now is, we never can. It is all easy if our troops march as well as the enemy, and it is unmanly to say they cannot do it.